now, the greatest radio shows of all time.
Suspense.
The Shadow Node.
Washington calling David Harding, Counterspy.
Classic Radio Theater.
The Great Gildersleeve.
Fibber McGee and Molly.
Dragnet. Gunsmoke.
The Lone Ranger.
Now step back into our time machine with your host, Wyatt Cox.
Good evening, friends of the Inner Sanctum.
A Thursday full of crime with episodes of This Is Your FBI, Broadway Is My Beat, Counterspy, The Lives of Harry Lime, and Superman. That's all straight ahead here on this Sure Happy It's Thursday, 23rd day of May, 144th day of the year, 222 days remaining. Mexico declares war on the U.S. on this date in 1846. The first talking cartoon of Mickey Mouse, the Carnival Kid, released on this date in 1929. In 1934, Bonnie and Clyde ambushed by police and killed in Black Lake, Louisiana. 1945, Heinrich Himmler, the head of the SS, committed suicide while in Allied custody. In 1960, Israeli Prime Minister David Ben-Gurion announced Nazi war criminal Adolf Eichmann had been captured. In 1969, The Who, the rock band, released the first rock opera, Tommy. On Capitol Hill on this date in 1976, a secretary for Congressman Wayne Hayes of Ohio, a Democrat, claimed she was being paid to be his mistress. 27-year-old Elizabeth Ray told the Washington Post she couldn't type or file or answer the phone. Congressman Hayes, who had divorced his wife of 38 years and married his veteran Ohio office secretary shortly before this story broke, replied to reporters.
Well, let me say that my family and I are deeply disturbed about this, and I am very much concerned about its effect on my wife of 6 weeks, for whom I have a deep love and affection. And let me say categorically that Miss Ray was never hired for any other purpose than to work from 9 to 5.
Hayes would later admit to many of the allegations, except that Ray was his mistress. He would resign from Congress on September 1st of that year, 1976. 1984, President Reagan praised William Casey, his embattled CIA director, in an appearance with Casey a day after a House subcommittee report implicated the spy chief in the pirating of President Carter's briefing papers during the 1980 presidential campaign.
We found that over a dozen officials and aides in the Reagan-Bush campaign saw Carter briefing papers or actually used them. Yet no one seems to know just how they got them. We do not find that believable. False statements to a congressional investigation are potential violations of federal law.
Congressman Donald Albosta, Democrat from Michigan, Casey would die of a brain tumor May 6, 1987, 3 years later, at the age of 74. 1985, U.S. engineer Thomas Patrick Kavanaugh sentenced to life in prison for attempting to sell stealth bomber secrets to the Soviet Union.
Thank you.
The final first-run episode of Star Trek The Next Generation aired this week in 1994, the first syndicated series to ever be nominated for a Primetime Emmy Award for Outstanding Drama Series. The series received a number of accolades, 19 Emmys, 2 Hugo Awards, 5 Saturn Awards, and a Peabody Award. In Oklahoma City on this date in 1995, what remained of the Alfred P. Murrah Federal Building imploded, getting rid of a stark reminder of the bombing there. 1999, World Wrestling Entertainment superstar Owen Hart fell to his death during the pay-per-view Over the Edge at Kemper Arena in Kansas City after a botched entrance stunt. 2014, 7 people, including the perpetrator, are killed, another 14 injured in a killing spree near the campus of the University of California, Santa Barbara. 46 people killed on this date in 2015 as a result of floods caused by a tornado in Texas and Oklahoma. And in 2017, Philippine President Rodrigo Duterte declared martial law in Mindanao following the Islamic terrorist group the Maute's attack in Marawi. Passing away on this date in history, comedian Moms Mabley, such a delightful lady. Actor Georgie Jessel, actor Sterling Hayden, pro wrestler Ray Candy, the Candyman, Ann Mira, comic, so very funny, very, very funny. Actor Roger Moore, the Saint on television, and also Bond at one point. And a Japanese pro wrestler, Hana Kimura, committing suicide. Cyberbullying. Now, among those born on this date in history include actor Douglas Fairbanks, the man called X, Herbert Marshall, actor-musician Scatman Crothers, clarinetist and bandleader Artie Shaw, actress-dancer Betty Garrett. He was Alf on Green Acres and Charlie on The Danny Thomas Show. Sid Melton, born on this date. Singer Helen O'Connell, also Rosemary Clooney. The inventor of the synthesizer, Robert Moog, the Moog synthesizer, and the roots in a lot of the electronic music you hear today, and a young man known as Wyndham Rotunda, better known to WWE fans as Bray Wyatt, born on this date in history. He passed away just last year at the very young age of 36.
Hi, this is Jeff Foxworthy. It is now time for the birthday announcements. The following people are now officially older than dirt.
And those who were still with us include TV's Mrs. Barney Miller, Barbara Barry, 93 years old today, Joan Collins, 91, Kathy from the television Father Knows Best, Lauren Chapin, 79, country singer Shelley West, Dottie West's daughter, 66. Writer Mitch Albom is 66. Price is Right host Drew Carey is 66 today as well. From Dumb and Dumber, Karen Duffy is 62. And singer Jewel turns 50.
1997.
You love me and so you will see. You're meant for me.
Jewel, 50 years old today. Those just a few of the people celebrating the 23rd day of May as their birthday. If this happens to be your birthday,
we baked you a birthday cake. If you get it to me, and you moan and groan and woe, don't forget we told you so.
Happy birthday!
Happy birthday!
Make a wish, dear, and blow out the candles.
Here they go.
Now we'll deal with crime this hour for the rest of the show. As we have episode now, This Is Your FBI, Stacey Keach starring as an agent. This goes back 72 years to May 23rd, 1952, and that's next.
This is Dennis James. Civil defense preparedness is important to all of us living in today's nuclear age. For information on the importance of first aid training in protecting your home and family, here is a message from Leo A. Hoig, Director of the Office of Civil and Defense Mobilization.
First aid training can prepare you to meet emergencies quickly when time is precious. If we are ever attacked, medically trained personnel will be busy aiding the desperately ill and injured. Your first aid training could save the life of a member of your family, a friend, a neighbor. You can't always count on someone else helping. Will you know what to do? Take the first step today. Enroll in a Red Cross first aid course. Knowledge of first aid is good common sense and good civil defense. Be sure you are prepared for any emergency.
And on this Thursday, Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox, we go back 72 years. May 23rd, 1952, this is your FBI.
The Equitable Life Assurance Society presents This Is Your FBI. This Is Your FBI, the official broadcast from the files of the Federal Bureau of Investigation. Presented, transcribed as a public service by the Equitable Life Assurance Society of the United States and the Equitable Society's representative in your community. What is your biggest money problem today? Owning your own home? Providing for your children's education? Retiring when you're young enough to enjoy it? Then why not ask the man who knows best how to help you with your problems? Ask your local Equitable Society agent. He's a specialist in these matters. In about 14 minutes, I'd like to tell you more about the men who represent the Equitable Society and how they may help you enjoy the advantages of membership in the Equitable Society. Tonight, the subject of our FBI file, armed robbery. It's titled Hot Ice.
The Federal Bureau of Investigation maintains a constant study of the fluctuation in the volume of unlawful activities in every section of the country. For by knowing the trends in crime, it is better able to meet the threat. Constantly throughout the year, crime reports and fingerprint arrest records forwarded by the local police are reviewed by your FBI, and a summary of the facts printed semi-annually in a booklet called The FBI Uniform Crime Reports. The last issue of that report reveals, among other facts, that the number of women arrested in the United States is rising at a tremendous rate. Nor are all their crimes petty infractions. Last year, for example, three women every day were arrested for criminal homicide. The figures on other crimes committed by female lawbreakers showed that women were beginning to constitute a major factor in the field of crime. Tonight's FBI file opens in a Midwestern women's prison. A large workroom is filled with inmates making uniforms for male prisoners and other penal institutions. In one corner, several girls are seated at a long table cutting material as another inmate returns to her place.
Laura, you see the board?
Yeah.
What would they say?
They turned me down.
Ah, oh, that's too bad.
Throw me my shoes.
Yeah, so. Sure. The board give you any reason?
The same old thing. Fourth offenders don't get a break.
No, well, you'll be out in 10 days anyway.
That's not soon enough.
You've been here over 5 months. What difference is 10 more days?
Plenty.
Hey, watch what you're cutting.
Oh, sorry, Flo.
Guy better have awful short legs.
Flo, you got anything waiting for you tomorrow?
Yeah, two ex-husbands.
You want to work on something with me?
Well, sure.
Well, my boyfriend was Happy Harrison.
Yeah, so I heard.
You see, just before he died, he robbed a place and hid the loot on the Crescent Beach Pier in the gyp auction joint he had.
What kind of loot was it?
$30,000 worth of jewelry, rings, watches, bracelets, everything. It's in a box wrapped in tissue paper and velvet.
Huh? Who else knows?
Nobody.
Why are you telling me?
Because you're getting out tomorrow, and the pier is due to open next week.
Oh.
P. pick up that box and hold it till I'm loose. Then what?
I'll split it with you.
How do I get it? It's the last place on the pier. In the back room, there's a loose floorboard under the window. Just lift it up and reach in.
That's all?
Mm-hmm. I'll meet you at the Star Hotel as soon as I'm out.
Meanwhile, on the long, gaily decorated Crescent Beach Pier, men are working on the various amusement stands, getting ready for next week's big opening. At one of the stands, a middle-aged man is tinkering with some wires under the counter when he hears someone call him.
Hey, Vinegar.
Yeah?
Company.
What? Well, look at here. Well, Herbie.
You old goat.
Look at you, you old windbag.
How are you, Vinegar?
Broke as a kid's toy.
Don't shake, son. We're even.
Say, Herb, what are you doing here?
Ran into Smitty, and he said you'd hooked up with his ragbag.
Well, sir, look at you. It's great to see you.
It's been a long time.
Yes, sir. See, you got this the Chicago Fair.
33.
That's the best shell game I ever ran.
Hey, you remember the sucker who lost 300 and then yelled copper? What a night.
Oh, what a night is right.
Say, you know, you never gave me my half of that 300.
Yes, sir. Didn't I?
No.
Well, I must have forgot it.
You need a hand here?
Okay, Herbie, but Herb, no swing.
Vinegar, would I steal from you?
Yes. Come on, walk around here and I'll let you in.
Yeah.
Oh, dear, dear, dear. The guy who put this latch on certainly hated his job. Yeah, there she is.
Hey, a nice wheel you got.
Yeah, yeah, it's a dandy. It swings easier than the old ones.
Yeah. Where's the control?
Well, now, that's what I'm working on now. Come on, bend down here.
Wires?
Yeah, I like them much better than the old foot control.
Yeah, they're not as sure.
Herb, when I get finished, I promise you, no mark will win anything bigger than a clay pipe or one of them wallets made out of genuine paper.
What's in the back there?
Oh, back there, that's just an empty room. The guys who had this place last year had a pretty good touch. Phony auction.
Afternoon at the local FBI field office, Special Agent Jim Taylor reports to Agent in Charge Cordell.
Welcome to the office, Taylor.
Thank you, sir.
What desk were you on at Salt Lake City?
Interstate theft.
Good. Well, the man who just transferred out left this file. Take it over.
All right.
It's a jewel theft that took place on the other side of the lake 6 months ago. Thief came back across the state line by boat and was seen by a policeman coming off the Crescent Beach amusement pier.
Do we know who the thief was?
Yeah. The victim made a positive identification. There's a man named Harrison. The policeman stopped Harrison, searched him, found a gun, and arrested him. On the way to the station, Harrison made a break. The policeman fired, but he kept going.
Did he get away?
Well, for a few hours. He was arrested at his girl's house and died the next day at City Hospital.
The officer find the stolen jewelry?
No, and it's never turned up. Finding it will be one of your jobs.
No, I see. Oh, how about that girl that you mentioned?
Her name's Nora Ridley. She got 6 months for harboring Harrison, and she's due to be released next week. Here's a file on her.
Thanks. Aside from their relationship, did anything point to her knowing where the loot was hidden?
No, but if Harrison told anybody, it must have been her.
All right, sir, I'll put her under surveillance when she's released.
She is. All right, Herbie. Go ahead, now spin it.
You're spinning.
Okay, boy, now just throw a number at me.
11.
11. Now you watch that wheel.
36.
Huh? Hey, that can't be. It had to stop at 11.
I told you foot control was better.
I got enough wires hooked up now to get Honolulu short wave.
Vinegar, it just don't work.
Now, you wait a minute. You wait till I get under this counter. Then you spin her again.
Thought you said the pier don't open till Friday.
Well, it don't.
Here comes a player.
Huh? Where?
The girlie.
Oh, well, well, well. Can I help you, lady?
Well, I...
Go ahead, lady. Try your luck. Win a coffee pot, a blanket, that beautiful clock, anything on the counter.
We're not really open yet, but if you're this anxious...
I must have the wrong place.
That's him? What are you looking for?
The last place on the pier.
Well, if there's anybody further, he's working in a submarine.
But I thought this was where they had auction.
Oh, dear, that was last year. What did you want to buy, lady?
We'll get you anything you want, anything from a harmonica to an elephant.
Well, I'm really looking for a job.
Oh, well, you're right. You did come to the wrong place.
I need one real bad. I'm broke, hungry,
No, lady, please, please, please. If you want to match troubles, I'll spot you five and let you go first.
Vinegar.
Mm-hmm.
A pretty girl spinning the wheel might help.
Oh, wait a minute. What's the matter with you? We ain't taking in a buck yet, and you're adding to the act. The answer is no, lady. N-O-E, no.
Okay.
Vinegar, you should have hired her.
Oh, why don't you stop? Never mind that. Never mind. Let's get these wires fixed, or we'll wind up with an honest wheel.
Hey, stand back. Let's get a look at you. Hey, you look great. Come on, sit down.
Thanks.
Ah, where you been?
On vacation. The state paid for it.
Oh. Well, what do you want to drink?
Oh, nothing, thanks. What are you doing now, Larry?
Oh, I got a little action going.
Would you like some real action?
Like what?
Like the loot from a big robbery?
Which one?
Happy Harrison's last job.
Where would you get that?
I was in with his girl.
Nora Ridley?
Yeah, you know her?
Well, before she started to go with Happy.
Well, she told me where the loot is.
Where?
On the Crescent Beach Pier, under the floor of one of the stands.
Well, why don't you glom it?
Well, I tried to, but I can't. There's $30,000 worth of stuff.
How much is your end?
Half. Help me, and I'll split my share with you.
Don't sound right.
What don't?
The whole deal. Why should Nora give you half?
Who else was she going to ask to pick up the stuff? The warden? Oh, now, look, Larry. If breaking into places was my line, I wouldn't be here.
Okay. I'll go out there with you.
When?
What's wrong with tonight?
Got some new information on that jewelry, Mr. Cordell.
Good.
I re-interviewed a pawnbroker named Parker, the one who corroborated Harrison's alibi.
I think I remember him.
He's the one who testified Harrison was in his store at the time of the robbery.
Oh, yes.
Parker's shop was raided by the police. He was arrested for fencing stolen property.
When was this?
Last week. I just spoke to him at city jail, and he admitted that he lied about Harrison.
He get the jewelry?
Well, Harrison promised to deliver it, but he didn't live long enough to do it.
Well, Parker have any idea where it was?
No, sir, but from something he said, it might be in the general area of that amusement pier.
Uh-huh.
Told me Harrison had a business out there tonight.
What kind?
He didn't know that or exactly where it was.
Well, the lakefront's a pretty large community.
I searched the real estate records. Nothing was listed for Harrison. Oh, and here's a list of every concession they had out at the pier last year.
Mm-hmm. Did Parker know anything at all about the business?
Just that Harrison didn't operate it himself. I took his picture out to the pier, showed it around. No one recognized him. However, if you think the angle is worth pursuing, I'll keep checking on it.
I think it's the next stand.
You think it is?
Oh, it's the last one. I know that.
Yeah. Wish we could see where we're going.
Yeah. Try the flashlight again.
This just lets you see the fog a little better.
Mm-hmm. Hold it.
This the place?
Uh-huh. The door's around on the side. You ought to be able to handle that lock.
Watch. Never mind the switch. The flash will work in here.
There's a loose board in this corner.
Here, hold a light.
Okay. See anything?
Jackpot.
Huh? I can't see.
Tissue paper. Velvet.
Now, get the box.
Hey.
Is it too heavy to lift?
It's gone.
We will return in just a moment to tonight's exciting case from the official files of your FBI. But right now, I'd like to have you hear from Mrs. Marie Twining. Mrs. Twining has been a member of the Equitable Society for a number of years. Could you tell us, Mrs. Twining, what made you and your husband decide to join the Equitable?
It was this program that started, Mr. Keating. My husband and I were worried about the future, and we heard about a life insurance plan that sounded like the answer. So we telephoned our local Equitable Society agent, and he dropped around to see us. Well, after that meeting, you have no idea what a feeling of relief we had. He outlined a plan that showed us how to provide for the future. He made it all seem so simple and so sensible.
Building the right life insurance plan is simple, Mrs. Twining, if you know how. And Equitable Society men really know how.
I'll tell you, Mr. Keating, it's wonderful to know you're protected no matter what happens.
Well, that's the aim of every Equitable Society man. You see, Equitable men are helpful, friendly men who have made a study of life insurance and its great value in building financial protection for the American family. They want you to be protected, and they know the best dollar and cents way to protect you. And backing up every Equitable man is a trained staff of experts in the Equitable Society's home office, actuaries, technicians, and economists. Remember this: careful planning will reduce your money worries. One of the surest ways to plan carefully is to consult your local Equitable Society representative. He'll be glad to visit you and discuss your problems thoroughly, any time is convenient to you and without obligation. Simply consult your local telephone directory for the name of your local Equitable representative. Or write the Equitable Society.
That's E-Q-U-I-T-A-B-L-E.
The Equitable Life Assurance Society of the United States. And now back to the FBI file, Hot Ice. A recent report on crime mentioned the common public misconception that jewel thieves are well-dressed, intelligent, high-living criminals who make fortunes in a few minutes. The truth is that, like most other criminals, the jewel thief is a maladjusted person of either sex and any age who usually lives in a cheap rooming house or run-down hotel. No criminal, in spite of an occasional momentary success, lives a life to be envied. Because every case is investigated as thoroughly as the one you are now hearing dramatized, the criminal must live in constant fear, must know that sooner or later, the chase will end as it always does, in failure for him. Tonight's FBI file continues a few days later at the stand on the amusement pier.
Oh, yeah. Herb, I did it.
Did what?
I fixed them wires. Now, son, if we want to, we can make that old wheel whistle, Dixie.
In what key?
I don't believe in it, huh? All right. Go ahead, spin it.
Really?
There she goes. Now, son, hit me with a number.
All right. 21.
Good old 21. And there you are, 21.
Vinegar, what about that break?
Hmm? Did you notice that?
Yes.
Now, the suckers won't hear it.
Not if you use half the place for a shooting gallery.
Well, if it gets too tough, we'll let them win.
Let them win? Vinegar, I'd rather hear you knock your mother.
Oh, say, Herbie, wait a minute. Look here. I've got some costume jewelry under the counter. Yeah, look at that stuff. We can use these things for prizes.
That's too junky looking. Who conned you into buying this slum?
Nobody. The guys who ran this auction joint last year must have left it behind. I found it in the back room the other day.
There's the tip-off. If it was worth putting back into popcorn boxes, they wouldn't have left it.
Well, maybe it'll be okay if we polish it up. As long as we got the stuff, might as well use it.
Pardon me, Mr. Cordell.
Oh, yes, Taylor.
I think I found an angle on that Harrison case.
Good.
No one at the lakefront recognized Harrison's picture, but I think I picked up a lead.
What's that?
An address of Harrison's, 31 Motor Avenue. It turned out to be a warehouse.
You been there yet?
Yes, sir. It was empty.
Well, who's using it now?
No one. It's exactly the way it was when Harrison left just before that robbery.
Oh, but that was 6 months ago.
Well, he had a year's rent paid in advance.
Well, what's this angle you found?
I ran across some shipping receipts in the place, so I checked the records down at the express company.
Harrison used the place to store stolen goods?
Well, that I don't know. The express record showed 3 shipments about this time last year from the Jordan Company in Rivertown.
What business are they in?
Well, the receipts didn't show what the shipments contained, but I've wired the company.
Good.
Oh, Mr. Cordell, Harrison's ex-girl is due to be released tomorrow.
Well, never mind the surveillance on her. I'll put another agent on that. You stay with this.
Hello.
Larry?
Yeah, Flo.
I went out to the stand again this morning. The loot is there. The old guys are going to use it for prizes.
What?
They think it's glass.
Oh, great. Did you make another pitch for a job?
Yeah, and I got it. I'm a shill starting tomorrow.
Well, what's your trouble? Go in and light finger this stuff.
Oh, you can't steal anything from those two. You better get out here.
Okay, when?
It'll make no difference. The old guys will be working in the place all night.
What for?
Getting ready for the opening.
Yeah, I'll see you around 11.
I just got a wire from the Jordan Company.
What did Harrison buy?
Cheap wristwatches by the dozen.
Oh?
6 cross altogether.
Hmm. I thought we knew about all his businesses, but we never heard about a jewelry store.
Or anything come in on that Nora Ridley surveillance?
She returned to the city on the first possible train and went directly to the Star Hotel.
Is that where she's living?
No. She was looking for a Flo Braddock. Well, Miss Braddock checked out this morning.
Oh? Who's she?
Former cellmate of Nora Ridley's, released a week ago.
I see.
The report said Miss Ridley got quite excited when she learned her friend had gone.
Where'd she go from there?
Well, that just happened a few minutes ago.
Oh.
But as she was leaving the hotel lobby, she picked up a timetable for buses to the beach.
The beach again?
Yeah. Keeps popping up.
See, Mr. Cordell, there's a place there that could have used 6 gross cheap watches.
At the beach?
Yeah, I think so. You still have that list of last year's pier concessions?
Even the birds are walking.
Hey, where's our coffee?
No coffee. Never even got to the Java joint. I've been all this time groping my way back here.
Well, if it's this way tomorrow night, we'll wind up playing the wheel ourselves.
Flo?
Yeah?
You better stop polishing that junk and go home.
I gotta wait around for my boyfriend.
This looks worse than it was in Frisco.
Yes, brother, and it is.
I thought you two haven't seen each other in 20 years.
Frisco was 1920.
That's right. 1920, that's when we met. Yeah, it was such a foggy night, we picked each other's pockets.
I knew he was a fellow professional when I reached in and found 3 wallets. That's when we teamed up.
Yeah. You worked together?
Yeah, for 10 years.
How come you split up?
Oh, yeah. Well, that happened in Frisco, too. Also in the fog. I was Punjab, the Indian fortune teller.
Oh, man, what a touch that was.
Was that a... Yeah, no expenses. I used a towel from the hotel for a turban, and my crystal ball was a goldfish bowl turned upside down.
Can you make much telling fortune?
You can the way we did it. Vinegar used to wait till he got a mark who looked soft. Then he'd sell them a paper bag and tell them they could double all their money if they went home, loaded the bag, and buried it. When they left the tent, I was supposed to follow them and dig it up. The first night we're open, Vinegar got a mark who was perfect. Rich, old, and stupid.
Oh. I can remember him now.
When Vinegar told him he could double his money, he said, even if I put $2,000 in the bag.
So I gave him 2 extra bags.
Well, I started following him home in this fog. He walked down towards the waterfront. I didn't want him to get suspicious, so I stayed about a half block behind and followed his footsteps. The next thing I know, I'm swimming.
What?
This guy caught a ferry.
And Herb didn't.
What? Oh. Hi, Larry.
Oh, hello there, son.
this your boyfriend?
Yep.
Flo, get the stuff.
It's all here in the box. I just finished polishing it.
Pretty good. Close it and let's go.
Whoa, Nellie. Whoa, boy. Those are prizes. If you want them, you got to win them.
No, I don't.
Pal,
your gun is showing.
Yeah, don't clown. It's real.
Hey, Flo, you didn't tell us that your boyfriend was in the artillery.
I forgot.
Come on. We got a train to catch.
Don't struggle. I got the gun. Nora. Hello, Flo.
Oh, thanks, lady, but you didn't have to take a chance like that for us.
Not to save that junk.
Hand it over.
You want it, too?
That junk is only worth about $30,000.
What? You mean it's the McCoy?
Yeah.
Vinegar, you were right. They would have made good prizes.
Okay, let's have the box.
Sure.
Is it all here? Yeah, and Nora, I didn't want to do this. He made me.
She's a liar.
Nora, you know I wouldn't double-cross you.
Don't feel so bad about it. I wasn't going to cut you in anyway.
What?
Well, thanks for polishing the stuff. I'll see you around.
Hold it right there.
What?
Well, I hope it's this crowded tomorrow.
I'll take the gun and that jewelry.
Cops.
That's right. We're special agents of the FBI. You three are under arrest.
Ridley, Flo Braddock, and Larry Marlowe were convicted and sentenced to terms in federal penal institutions. Approaching the stand at the amusement pier, Agent Taylor spotted the special agent keeping a surveillance on Nora Ridley. They followed her through the dense fog to the stand with results you have just heard. Agent Taylor went to that part of the pier after checking the list of concessions and learning one had been an auction house the previous year. An auction house specializing in cheap watches, rings, and costume jewelry. And so another case from the files of your FBI was closed. Closed with the arrest and conviction of all the criminals. In addition, the stolen jewelry was returned to its original owner. Once more illustrating how your FBI protects your property in addition to your life and your liberty.
You believe you'd be happier if you made more money? Well, everybody believes that, so you'll have to look elsewhere for the answer. The right answer is, make the best use of the money you have. Now, there is one man who can help you do just that. He is your local Equitable Society agent. Without any obligation to you, he is ready to help you plan for future security and peace of mind. Simply consult your local telephone directory for the name of your local representative of the Equitable Life Assurance Society of the United States.
Next week, we will dramatize another case from the files of the Federal Bureau of Investigation. Its subject, armed robbery. Its title, The Larceny Express.
The incidents used in tonight's Equitable Life Assurance Society's broadcast are adapted from the files of the Federal Bureau of Investigation. However, all names used are fictitious, and any similarity thereof to the names of places or persons, living or dead, is accidental. Tonight, the music was composed and conducted by Frederick Steiner. The author was Jerry D. Lewis. Your narrator was William Woodson, and Special Agent Taylor was played by Stacey Harris. Others in the cast were Parley Bear, Anthony Barrett, Betty Blythe, Walter Catlett, Marlene Lightbody, and John Stevenson. This Is Your FBI is a Jerry Devine production. This is Larry Keating speaking for the Equitable Life Assurance Society of the United States and the Equitable Society's representative in your community, and inviting you to tune in again next week at the same time when the Equitable Life Assurance Society will bring you another thrilling transcribed story from the files of the Federal Bureau of Investigation. The Larceny Express on This Is Your FBI. Stay tuned for the adventures of Ozzie and Harriet. There's fun for the whole family when Ozzie and Harriet come your way next. This program came to you from Hollywood. This is ABC Radio Network.
72 years ago, May 23rd, 1952, This Is Your FBI on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Visit our webpage, classicradio.com. Stream. Coming up next, Larry Thor as Detective Danny Clover in Broadway Is My Beat.
Gonzalez, I think I have it. I hear something.
Pedro, are you getting through?
Yes, yes, at last.
From Mars? You're really in radio contact with the Mars?
Yes, Gonzalez, it's Mars. This message is man's first communication with the planet Mars.
Pedro, why they say?
This is phenomenal. Positively amazing.
Here they are. Listen.
Do you know what to do in case of a civil defense emergency? You must know these two numbers, 640 and 1240. They may save your life. Mark these numbers, 640 and 1240, on your standard radio dial now. These are your Conrad frequencies, your only way of getting life-saving civil defense instructions and information during an enemy attack. Only on radio, only at 640 or 1240 on your radio will you hear the Conrad broadcasts. Be sure you have a battery radio in your home should electric power be knocked out. Also, make certain your car radio is in working order. Remember, in a civil defense emergency, tune to
640-1240-Conrad. By the way, before I get to this letter, I want to acknowledge that still applies today. Not the Conrad part, but other stuff goes down. Your cell phones will go down. The internet will go down. Turn to radio. We have that here. Diane Lawthorn was listening to our May 16th program. And I made comments that I was just talking way too much. And she said, God bless you, Diane, says, you just go ahead and talk. I love the format you present. The program reminds me of Decades TV. Decades TV that combined news footage with classic programs. It was removed from my area. Due to low ratings, I guess, people don't care for history, and that's sad. I was raised by my daddy, born in 1917. He lived through so much history, it's incredible. I spent so much time listening to his stories that made me hit those history books. I still do. Daddy liked Ike, Lindy too, and hated Hoover. He liked the Flappers. I could go on rambling forever. I appreciate your shows. Thanks. I appreciate that, and here's what happened. The folks at Weagle Broadcasting killed Decades TV. Part of the reason they killed Decades was because of the programming. It duplicated a lot of other stuff that was going on. And they moved to catchy comedy, focusing primarily on sitcoms, some variety shows, sketch comedy. But they're still doing binge weekends. So there you go. So that's what happened. And I guess they had Bill Curtis on. Bill Curtis, another Kansas boy. Well, I shouldn't say Kansas boy. He was studying to be a lawyer in Topeka at Washburn University. He was asked to fill in on a temporary news assignment at WIBW-TV when the big tornado outbreak hit there. And he ended up staying an on-air news reporter, a news anchor in Chicago. He anchored the CBS Morning News in the 80s and did a lot of other stuff. But, yeah, there's your Kansas connection for you. That's probably why I blather so much. If you haven't read the story of Bill Curtis, with K-U-R-T-I-S, you can read the story about that 1966 tornado in Topeka, Kansas. It was ugly, ugly, ugly. Alrighty, now, let's get to 71 years ago, May 23rd, 1953. Larry Thor in the Elliot Lewis-helmed Broadway Is My Beat. This episode entitled The Robin Forrest Murder Case.
Broadway's My Beat, from Times Square to Columbus Circle, the gaudiest, the most violent, the lonesomest mile in the world.
Broadway's My Beat with Larry Thor as Detective Danny Clover. When it's May and the nighttime sighs briefly, begins the weaving of mists into silken fabric of its dying, Broadway is still. Broadway waits for death of night, for the first cry of day. Entwined with mist threads, the echoes of earlier whisperings, and light pools spilled from earlier neon, diminishing now, contracting into cores of darkness. Dance of litter where dreams were and promises were, and through it, erratic dance of a sodden man who stops, then leans for a while against the edge of night, walks on, and in his wake, ebb of nighttime. And at headquarters, walk a corridor on your way to a room where you'd been summoned by Detective Mugovan. Old thoroughfare to the interrogation room to see... Well, you'll see when you get here, Mugovan, it said.
The poor soul sat crying by a sycamore tree. Her hand on her bosom, her head on her knees, sing, Willow, Willow.
Well, you can cut that out now, miss. The lieutenant is here, and the lieutenant has got your message.
Her salt tears fall from her, which soften the stone. Sing, Willow.
You hear me, miss? You can end it now, anytime.
Drunk?
In my time, Danny, I have been in the company of many lady drunks, but
never. What's she doing here? Why isn't she in the tank?
She was there, Danny, a couple hours ago, picked up off a village street about midnight. They booked her, searched her, did all their little things, and then sent her up to us.
I call my false love, but
lady,
what's...
Lady, lady,
why did they send her up to us, Mugovan?
Over here on the table, Danny. This knife, it was found in her purse. There was blood on it. Fresh blood, human blood. I let the boys in technical have their way with the knife, and that's the report they came up with.
Who is she?
No identification.
Willow, Willow.
And like she is now, how she was when they picked her up. The wrinkled summer dress, the booze... One difference. The knife was in her purse.
Miss...
My false love said then... You know what he said? Give me, oh you, whose arms are soft and slender.
Look, miss...
Yeah, Danny, you talk to her. Be gentle. Be, well, like you are. Maybe you
and
shall...
And he said, against your heart so innocent and tender, a little love and some forgetfulness. Willow, Willow, Willow.
And then started to sway and lose control.
Hey, I got her, Danny.
Dawn all at once, and she was caught in its first light, supported by Detective Mugovan, looking up at him silently with suddenly stricken eyes. When he took her away to jail, she leaned against him, head to his chest. At 9 o'clock in the morning, after the small sleep, the day began again, with the juice of the orange and the coffee bean, proven best to enable you to face life. And when fortified with a glazed donut, enables you to face life bravely. Thus equipped, stride down headquarters corridor to your assigned cubicle. The man who's waiting for you offers you his hand, shakes yours once, gives it back to you with a slight underhand flip.
I'm Harold Tracy, Mr. Clover.
How do you do?
I was told to see you because my wife is missing, and I was told you had a woman booked last night for some reason or another, and her description checks with that of my wife.
What does your wife look like?
Again?
Again.
About this tall, coloring fair, hair light brown. Joan has a very small beauty mark right here at the corner of her lips. She...
Yeah, Danny?
Sergeant, the woman that was booked this morning about 4, the one without identity?
Who had the knife?
That's right. Get her up here in my office right away.
Only be a second, Danny. She was brought upstairs here for breakfast.
Mr. Tracy...
No, wait a minute. What's that mean, who had the knife?
Is your wife a drunk, Mr. Tracy?
No. Now tell me what...
Sure. Here, take a look.
What's this got to do with Joan?
Your wife was incoherent from booze early this morning, Mr. Tracy. If she's your wife, we've got upstairs. How come you're so concerned about her this morning? Why weren't you concerned enough about her last night to keep her out of trouble?
I don't have to listen to that kind of talk.
You do if you don't know how to take care of your wife. You've seen this knife before?
Let me see it. No. Drunk? Joan? No, no, it couldn't be. Look, you sure she's my wife?
No, but the description you gave me...
Wearing a black dress cut, That's another thing I can't understand about Joan.
Right in here, miss. Well, gentlemen, here she is.
What got into you, Joan?
I'm very sorry. I promise you I won't do it again.
That's the very least I'd expect you to say.
I'm ashamed of myself.
I should hope so.
I'll never embarrass you again, Hal. I've been bad.
I can't understand you.
I've been bad and...
Annie!
Hal, I hate you so much.
Danny, she's got the knife.
Mrs. Tracy.
Don't worry, Mr. Glover.
I do.
Joan.
I hate you with all my heart and soul.
And I'm going to kill you.
Put down that knife, Joan.
Kill you, Hal. Because all the years...
Give me that knife, Mrs. Tracy.
What's happened to her?
That Dr. Sinsky, you know.
Joan, what's happened to her?
You better go home now, Mr. Tracy.
All right.
Look up, Danny. Look up from your desk and get hit with it.
Marty.
Who else but Marty Udenfreund, to be exact? Hits you, huh? This tired face you remember, huh?
You look fine, Marty. Tanned.
You drove an open-air cab, you would also be tanned in the face. However, what happened to your particular set of values concerning the female of the species, I can't guarantee. Were you a cabbie?
What are you talking about, Marty?
That dame.
What dame?
What dame, he says to me. The dame the paper say you picked up booze happy in the village last night. With beauty spot close to lip. With knife in the bag. What dame, he says.
Oh, Mrs. Tracy, what about her?
Last night around 10 when she hailed me, I didn't know for Mrs. or Miss. All I know is a few remarks were passed, and suddenly I find myself nonchalant in the back seat of my cab, and my passenger is driving in the front. Ah, it was a pleasant change.
Go on.
Well, we do the park, we do the plaza, we do the East River. Then she hauls up in front of a joint in the village, invites me in. I say, thanks loads, lady, but I already had my quota of fun for tonight.
What club?
The Crocodile Club on Bank Street. You gotta understand, Danny, up to where we parted company, my passenger was only flap happy with the season.
Yeah, I understand. Thanks, Marty. See you around, Marty. Good afternoon. I'm looking for the manager of this club.
Truly?
Police.
Just one couple here, mister. A boy, a girl. A boy and a girl in a corner table. And see how they hold hands? Nah, isn't
you the manager?
I'm Leslie Cobb, and I manage. And just what is it that you need in the afternoon, you being a police officer and all?
Well, some information.
You?
About a woman named Joan Tracy. She was here last night.
Say that name again?
Joan Tracy.
About 5'4", about a 26-inch waist, and the little thing right here, the beauty mark. And suddenly emancipated. Call me Joan Tracy the Liberated. That one? The lady on a toot?
What about her?
I only had one drunk in here last night, and she swore to everybody her name was Joan, and she was free, free, free. Come what may, she said, which was a lie.
Oh?
She found a fellow. She found a fellow with a book of verses, and she had a jug of booze. Whether there was bread or not, I wouldn't know.
What are you talking about?
She went off with a boy in jeans and plaid shirt, who calls himself Robin Forrest, this week. Has a room down the corner, that way, an attic. And there to laugh and sorrow and taste...
Yeah. Thanks a lot.
And out of the jaws of the Crocodile Club, and onto Village Street in Maytime, past shop of French pastries and French legends scrawled in pink icing on sun-yellowed wedding cakes, and make the quick free translations and walk on. And leaning against doorway, the sandaled girl in batik sari, head posed against the hand-painted sign that reads, Jewels, Custom Made, Second Landing, and walk on to corner rooming house, where a boy who this week calls himself Robin Forrest is to be captured in his attic lair, where he usually is if he's not on the wing somewhere else. Attic is the room boasting the skylight. And ascend old stairs, banister carved with old memories, and onto landing, down hallway. And a faulty catch releases. Door drifts slowly into opening. Latticed rays of sun from fulcrum of skylight to hold in dust dance boy sprawled on floor. Boy in plaid shirt and jeans. Young man with knife wound. Young man dead. Young man murdered.
You are listening to Broadway's My Beat, written by Morton Fine and David Friedkin, and starring Larry Thor as Detective Danny Clover. Thanks to careless people, forest fires have a long season. That season has begun again with the coming of warm weather. In the interest of preserving our natural resources, we are all asked to be especially careful when in or near our woodlands. 9 fires out of 10 are man-made. Every fire makes a dent in our natural defenses. To keep our woodlands open and free for enjoyment, eliminate forest fires.
The season of promise is dying, and on Broadway its swift, silent passing goes unnoticed. Spring into summer means only the shifting of mannequins in a store window and draping them in less clothes, preserving only the precise curve of wrist. And still the serpents of light uncoil in identical pattern and leap skyward. And still the street is filled with sounds that were there yesterday, and the people, and the riot. But spring is dying, and summers are coming in. Hurry. Only so many tomorrows for the dream to come true. And where I was, office at police headquarters, late afternoon time. The hour of the police sergeant from Never Never Land, who had somehow gotten a job in New York.
Danny?
Come in, Gino.
Well, how did you like it?
How did I like what?
How did I like what, he says.
Yeah, that's what I said.
That's what I said, Danny. How did you like that book I give you?
Book?
I, the Corpse. You know, the first adventure of the twanger. That two-fisted guitar strumming...
Oh, well, I haven't read it yet. You see...
Well, Danny, here's the sequel, so you can read both in one sitting.
Thanks, Gino. Kiss Me, Irving?
What an adventure. In this one, the twanger cleans up Anne Arundel County in Maryland.
Thanks a lot, Gino.
Your jaw will drop.
Gino...
Mind it.
Gino, you have anything for me?
Report from Detective Dennison if your mood is such.
It is, believe me, it is.
That Mrs. Tracy is lying in a hospital room under the care of Dr. Sinsky, where she lies and stares at the ceiling and says not a word.
Go on.
Incidental information is all.
If you please.
Her mother died last week.
Oh?
Fell down the steps in her apartment house.
It was an accident then, for sure?
I think so. Says here on the report, if accidental death, checked here. It's checked, see?
What else, Gino?
Joan Tracy is a lady with a talent. She plays cello. In fact, there are 3 of them.
What?
In the trio. 2 friends and Joan Tracy. If you want who the 2 people are, Danny, well, here. If I seem like a daisical, Danny, the twanger, my jaw dropped.
Please, please, go away.
Mr. Caudalier?
It matters to you who I am?
Yes, it does. I'm from the police.
Thank you. I am Caudalier. Now, please, go away.
Police. On police business, Mr. Caudalier.
You wish to enter into negotiations with me concerning private piano lessons, concerning harmony, theory?
Concerning Joan Tracy.
Theory. Joan.
All right, if we'd talk inside?
Please. Then Joan is your business with me.
Because the boy she was with last night was found murdered.
A boy? Not her husband?
Not her husband.
I think I read of it. I'm not sure. Drunk, a knife, a death. So many in the newspapers. It becomes vague. It becomes so many Joans.
Another thing we know about this Joan, she was a friend of yours. She played cello in a trio that you...
And you wish my interpretation of Joan. What phrasings, what nuances, what dynamics would bring a woman like Joan to murder a boy, not her husband.
All I want from you...
I will tell you of Joan. The theory, okay?
All right, tell me.
A cringer. A woman who put on the face of a beaten child when no one lifted a finger to her.
You'll explain it to me, huh?
So you will understand. In a trio, when a cello makes a boo-boo in phrasing, in breathing, in emotion, looks are exchanged between the violin and the piano. When such looks are exchanged between us, Joan sometimes wept. cringed, looked beaten.
I still don't understand.
I will show you. On my piano. This is a passage for the cello from a trio we have often played. It is to be sung so, with heart, with subtlety, with delicacy, as I have played it. Joan played it so. Understand?
I think so.
Good. Now that is Joan. Strict tempo, strict pitch, and strictly without heart. That is Joan. What I said before to you. Please do it. Please go away.
I play the violin. There's Joan and her cello, Godalia with his piano, and I play the violin.
Well, I want to know about Joan, Mr. Vernon.
Not very good with the cello.
I've heard that. Other things, though.
I loved her once.
Oh?
In retrospect, it was pity more than anything else. I was filled with a sorrow for her.
Why?
This was before she was married, of course.
About the pity, Mr. Vernon, why?
She was, docile because of her mother, very domineering mother. A cliché of a domineering mother, a do-this-do-that cliché of a domineering mom, and if you don't, I'll fall on my face with a heart attack and you'll be sorry, you know? And I pitied Joan.
I see.
One day I took her in my arms, and I liked it. It started off by feeling sorry. When I was holding her, I forgot my purpose in doing so. I said to myself, love.
Tell me something, Mr. Vernon, about this trio.
A simple thing. We all studied at the academy. We met. One evening long ago, we said, let's have a trio. We're none too expert, really. We saw and pound and call it Beethoven, and it's a fine time.
And you were in love with Joan once, but not now, is that right?
Right. You see, I recognized what kind of woman Joan was and what I really felt for her, and that she would need a man exactly like her mother.
You know her husband?
Just pokes his nose in, waves a riding crop at us, and vanishes.
When's the last time you saw Joan?
About, let me see, 4 days ago, Tuesday.
Tell me about it.
To console her mother's death.
Well, I understand her mother fell down the steps and died.
Well?
Well, what?
You want me to say, isn't that nice?
Oh, forget it. I just wanted you to comment on whether you thought
her mother was pushed. How do I know? I got better things to do than conjecture on a horror like her.
Okay. Tell me about the last time you saw Joan.
Joan was in the library at her home. I went to her. She was playing the cello, sawing away tunelessly and loud. She noticed I was there finally, grinned at me, picked up the cello and broke it over an antique brass pot. And don't ask me whether the latter's symbolic.
And that's all?
Not quite. She sobbed then. And I felt sorry for her again and took her in my arms again, and I thought suddenly what a stupid girl this was. I said goodbye to her.
Anything else you can tell me about her, Mr. Vernon?
Not a thing. She really isn't stupid, you know. My first impression was correct. To be pitied, that's more nearly correct.
And back in the street now, at city at 9 o'clock of May, time for stoop dweller to chart the course of new fallen star and also observe the nebulae in wake of the summer passage of a boy and girl through a million private comets. Time of the chuckle and the elbow poke in the ribs. Time to check condition of tenement roof and stake out the place of summer sleeping. Walk through currents of May night. Somewhere between where you were and headquarters, stop for the sandwich and the coffee with conjectures on the murder of a boy who had read poetry to a drunken woman. A woman who had tried to kill her husband in your presence, who the night before had driven a cab, had shouted in a Greenwich Village club that she was free, free, free. And leave them alongside the tip, because there were new conjectures to be had at headquarters, from study of reports, from further musings against May night, and in a while from Detective Mugovan also.
About Joan Tracy's husband.
What about him?
Well, him, Joan Tracy's mother, different relationship, different age, different gender. But, but.
But what, Mugovan?
But peas from the same pod. Happens in a pod sometime. Now, the way I know is one summer my seed man showed me charts.
You mind just about Tracy, her mother, her husband?
Oh, thanks.
Mugovan, so help.
Oh, don't get riled, kid. You've been doing legwork, I've been doing legwork, so just don't get riled, huh? Yeah, on your feet, Danny. Walk it. You haven't had enough of it, huh?
Look, don't you understand? I've been trying to tell
you... All right, Muggerman, tell me what?
What I found out from my legwork. From friends, neighbors, spectators on the life of Joan Tracy.
Well?
What I already told you. Her husband she tried to kill in front of. Her mother who fell down steps and died a week ago. Both the same type people. Both wielders of the big stick, tongue lashers of what they considered lesser persons in the human scale.
You'll explain it, huh, Muggerman?
Glad to. Now look, mother of Joan Tracy, one of those mothers. The kid, Joan, the woman, Joan, couldn't make a move, couldn't breathe, couldn't smile, couldn't cry until Mama gave the word. Up until Joan married Mr. Tracy, that is.
She married him, then what?
A word about the background of husband Harold Tracy. It seems a few years back he was headmaster in a boys' military academy. Seems he had codes of behavior for little boys. Oh, and disciplines to match. Pete Chirino of a chap with the willow rod, I understand. Now, Danny, you take a man like that, marry him to a woman like Joan, what have you got?
Yeah. Get on the phone. Get him down here, Muggerman. Just have a seat, Mr. Tracy.
How's my wife?
I understand you've been calling every hour.
They said she wouldn't talk, that she was just staring. Once...
What?
Once when I was a headmaster, there was a boy who did that. I took him for a walk. I talked with him. I cured him. He didn't do it anymore.
You ordered him to behave, is that right?
I illuminated for him the difference between proper and improper conduct. Joan already knows that. Mm.
Then all you think your wife needs is talking to by you.
Exactly.
Why did she want to kill you, Mr. Tracy?
You mean this morning, with a knife?
Of course, that's what I mean. Were there other times?
Certainly not this morning. Joan was drunk.
No, I don't think so.
I know my wife.
You know whether she ever tried to kill her mother?
Oh, are you serious?
Then she didn't push her mother down the steps, did she?
Joan was with me in Atlantic City when her mother fell.
Well, that's what I wanted to know. You see...
In here, Mrs. Tracy. Hello, Joan.
Hello, Hal.
You see, Clover? You ready to go home, Joan?
Whenever you say so.
You see, Clover?
Please, sit down, Mrs. Tracy.
Go ahead, Joan. In a little while, dear, I'm going to take you home and we'll have a little talk.
Hal?
What, dear?
If you ever get close to me, I'll try to kill you.
She don't like you at all, Mr. Tracy.
She's not drunk, either.
What have you people done to her?
Nothing. They haven't done a thing. They gave me time to just lie there in bed and scheme. They didn't bother me. I've got a lot of schemes. And if we go home together, one of them I like very much.
Joan. Joan.
Don't!
Joan!
Get away from her.
She's my wife.
You heard what he said. Get away from her. That's better.
Mrs. Tracy.
Yes. What?
You want to tell us about last night?
Joan, you don't have to.
I want to.
Go on.
I got very drunk. I met a boy who recited poetry. We got very drunk together. I passed out. I woke up. I think he was dead. I didn't know. I drank some more from the bottle and I walked out into the street. Then it was this morning and I was here.
You didn't have to say that.
Why not? Why not?
What's happened to you, Joan?
I'm free.
What?
You know.
I don't understand what she's talking about. She's a very sick woman. My wife is sick.
She'll get better.
That about does it, huh, Mr. Tracy?
What are you talking about?
Your wife's mother died last week.
I can tell it. I've been thinking about it. I know the words. When she died, I heard about it and I sat down to cry. I couldn't cry. I felt relieved.
You said free.
Free.
And of the kind of life you had with your mother. Afraid, docile.
Hal.
What?
That's why I was such a good wife to you. Why the transition was so easy, from daughter to bride. It was the same thing. You're the same kind of person.
You could have explained it to me.
No, not to you. You'd hit the air with your riding crop and demand obedience.
Joan, listen to me.
Joan, listen to me. Joan, listen to
me. When your mother died, it happened. You were free of both of them.
That's what I meant.
What about it, Mr. Tracy?
Well...
Well, what?
I had to show her, that's all. I caught up with her at that place, at that club in the village, as she was going out with that boy. I followed them. They were both in a stupor, a drunken stupor, when I walked in on them.
So you stabbed the boy and planted the knife on your wife?
It was sordid what you did, Joan. Ugly. Unbecoming. It needed to be stopped. I stopped it.
You killed a boy, Hal. You didn't stop anything. I may go now, may I not? Goodbye, Hal. One thing you can be sure of, you'll never be embarrassed by me again, wherever you are.
Dawn touches Broadway now. The last shadows leave and take away the night. And over the river a cloud drifts, and a bird dips and touches it with a wing. The people wake. The fury gathers and funnels out into the streets. Walk easy. Another day has come. The shock has come. It's Broadway. The gaudiest. The most violent. The lonesomest mile in the world. Broadway. My beat.
Broadway's My Beat stars Larry Thor as Detective Danny Clover, with Charles Calford as Tartaglia and Jack Crucian as Mugovan. The program is produced and directed by Elliot Lewis, with musical score composed and conducted by Alexander Courage. In tonight's story, Sammy Hill was heard as Joan and Whitfield Connor as Hal. Featured in the cast were D.J. Thompson, Jerry Hausner, and Harry Bartell. Bill Anders speaking. This Monday night on CBS Radio Suspense, Dick Haynes stars in Pigeon in the Cage. It concerns a man who is trapped in an elevator between floors, but who dares not call for help because his only possible rescuers are murderers. With this story, CBS Radio hopes once again to keep you in suspense this Monday night on most of these same stations. And remember, the top dramatic show of all, the Lux Radio Theater, is heard Monday nights on the CBS Radio Network.
There you have it. 71 years ago, May 23rd, 1953, Broadway Is My Beat. I failed to thank Diana Lawthorn for her very nice comment on our classic radio theater podcast that goes back a week ago. Thursday, May 23rd podcast. Thank you, Diana, and thank you for your thoughts and your reminiscences. It's always nice to hear from people who like what we do. And that's what we do that's different from anybody else's. I talk about the shows, and I talk about the times. It's not about the old radio shows exclusively. It's about history. That's what we do here. All right. Tomorrow, we will have more crime stories with an episode of Dragnet, an episode of Night Watch, the show that, before Cops, there was Night Watch. Also, an episode of Suspense, Agnes Moorhead in Weekend Special Death, Mr. District Attorney David Bryan starring in The Case of the Moving Van Murder, and another episode of Claudia. Coming up next, though, on this Thursday, we'll have an episode of Counterspy.
This is Dennis James, in the Office of Civil and Defense Mobilization, who has a message for you about the importance of a home shelter for survival in the nuclear age.
After a nuclear attack, any kind of cover will offer you some protection from radioactive fallout. An ordinary frame house will cut the radiation danger in half. For greater safety during an attack, get on the ground floor, away from doors or windows. A basement shelter offers even more protection, and an underground shelter with 3 feet of earth over it will give almost complete fallout protection. Give your family the best possible protection. Prepare a fallout shelter now. Free plans are available for building home shelters. Write to Post Office Box, Home Shelter, Battle Creek, Michigan, or contact your local civil defense office.
And I am looking at some of those reports right now. They're available at civildefensemuseum.com, civildefensemuseum.com, the Family Shelter Design Book, the Expedient Fallout Shelter Plans, July 1978 Guidance for Development of an Emergency Fallout Shelter Stocking Plan, and other things as well. Flip through there. You'll find some stuff that might be of interest to you if you are a nuclear bug. That's civildefensemuseum.com. Okay, you're listening to Classic Radio Theater. I'm Wyatt Cox. I think you knew that. And let's go back to May 23rd, 1948. Don MacLaughlin, Mandel, Kramer in an episode of the Phillips H. Lord fictionalized version of the FBI. It's called Counterspy.
David Harding, Counterspy, presented by the makers of Old Nick and Bitter Honey Candy Bar. And today we're happy to be able to repeat a special money-saving offer for all you folks who enjoy Old Nick and Bitter Honey candy bars.
We offer a 13-inch stainless steel slicing knife, guaranteed to equal knives selling at 75 cents to $1.
Sent to you for only 25 cents in coin, with two wrappers from either Old Nick or Bitter Honey candy bars. Here's where to send your order. Send to Old Nick, Box 144, New York 8, New York.
We'll repeat this address later, so have a pencil and paper ready to get the address correct.
And listen later for complete details.
Washington calling David Harding, Counterspy. Washington calling David Harding, Counterspy.
Harding, Counterspy, calling Washington.
David Harding, Chief, United States Counterspies, especially appointed to investigate and combat the enemies of our country, both at home and abroad, and to secure for every American the rights which are his under our Constitution.
Honey.
Ed, I didn't expect you to come home.
Well, I couldn't do any work after you called and told me about Kathy. How is she?
The doctor's still with her. Andy, he thinks it might be pneumonia.
Well, how did she look?
Feverish. She was whimpering when the doctor came. You feel so powerless when they're so young. They can't tell you what hurts, what's wrong.
Yeah, I know.
Oh, Andy, she'll be all right, won't she?
Of course she will, darling. Now, why don't you rest for a while? You didn't sleep at all last night.
Oh, neither did you.
Well, let's not argue the point.
Oh, hello, Mr. Gorham. Oh,
hello, Doctor.
Oh, you didn't have to come home from work.
I called him, Doctor.
I wanted to. The baby's... Well, how is she, Doctor?
Oh, she's holding her own, Mr. Gorham. I'd like to order a portable oxygen tent just as a precaution.
We'll order whatever you need.
It may be a little expensive.
Doc, it doesn't matter.
I know. I just wanted to keep everything straight. Now, is there another room in the house that we could move her to?
Well, sure.
Well, what do you want to move her for, Doctor?
Well, I'd like a place that isn't quite as damp and drafty.
Oh.
That's the driest room we have except for the kitchen.
Oh, I see. Well, we'll manage all right.
This whole place drips water 3 days after every rain.
Really? I thought these houses were just built.
They were, but not very well.
Oh. Well, don't worry. Longer, we'll move her to the hospital.
Yeah, sure. Say, tell me, Doctor, this house has been damp and drafty from almost the first month we moved in. Could living here have caused Kathy's pneumonia?
Well, now, I wouldn't like to be pinned down as to the cause, but... Well, I'd certainly say that living here hasn't helped to avoid it.
I see.
Well, Kathy will get better, won't she?
Yes, but...
But what, Doctor?
Well, if you can manage it, I think she should get out of this climate for a while. I should suggest the South for a month or two.
The South?
Thanks, Doctor. We'll take your advice.
Andy, wait.
We'll talk it over, Edie.
Well, now, I'll get back to my patient.
Andy, we can't afford a trip south at this time.
You bet we can.
Oh, where will the money come from?
From this dream house we bought. We're not going to make any more payments on it. We'll use the money to send you and Kathy south for a while.
Yes, but what about the money we've already put into the house?
Well, I'll think of something.
Oh, darling, we can't afford to lose all that.
Can we afford to lose Kathy?
Andy.
I'm sorry, honey. I shouldn't have said that. I just don't want you to worry about anything except her.
If we're not going to give Mr. Hobbs any more money, what will we do when we get the mortgage statement?
I'm not sure, darling, but that's not your worry.
All right, Andy.
Now, you start planning for that trip south. The minute the doctor says okay, you and Kathy go.
Andy, you didn't have to get a roommate on the train. We could have gone by day coach.
Edie, it's already paid for. Don't fret about it. Enjoy it.
All right.
Kathy looks good, doesn't she?
Oh, I hope she takes the trip all right.
Well, she's starting off okay. Sleeping like a log on that seat.
Well, this has been a lot of excitement for a one-year-old.
Yeah, I guess so.
Oh, darling, I wish you could go with us.
So do I. Somebody has to work.
What are you doing about the mortgage payments, Andy?
Well, I've been talking to some of our neighbors in the development, and they've been stuck just like we have.
Uh-huh.
Together, we may work something out.
Oh, don't get into any trouble, Andy.
I won't, darling. But don't you worry about it. Just have a good time. Well, now I'd better get off this train, or I'll be going with you.
Goodbye, Andy.
Goodbye, darling. Mr. Bradley? Andy Gorham. Yes. Can you come over to my place tonight about 8 o'clock? Yeah, that's right. See what we can do about these salt boxes that were sold to us as houses. Good. I'll expect you. Harold? Andy? 8 tonight okay for you? Yeah, my place. Right. Be seeing you. Tommy? Andy? We're going to meet here tonight. Count on you? Good. 8 o'clock. Bye. I know some of us here paid a little more for our houses than the rest of us. A larger house or more land. But whatever you paid, I think we're all agreed that it was too much for what we got.
No question about that.
Now, our individual complaints are pretty similar. Green wood, flooded cellars, crumbling foundations, poor flashings, bad drainage. Well, you know them as well as I do.
Perhaps better, Andy.
Perhaps.
Yeah.
But the point is, the majority of them can be repaired.
At whose expense?
Yeah,
I don't want to sink any more money into my house.
You won't have to, Tommy. At least I hope not.
Then who will, Mr. Gorham?
If we all stick together, Mr. Bradley, I think we can make the Oak Nub Real Estate Company bear the expense.
What? You've been drinking, Andy?
No, I'm serious.
It's a nice dream.
Yeah, but that's all it is. Mr. Hobbs of the real estate company has only one interest in these houses now. It's not repairing them. It's collecting on the mortgages.
Right, Tommy. And that's our weapon. We refuse to pay those mortgages.
What?
Until steps are taken to remedy our complaints.
What about foreclosure?
Well, that is a possibility, Mr. Bradley, and we should face it. But if we all stick together, I doubt that Mr. Hobbs will foreclose on 45 houses at once.
Yeah. It would certainly be bad publicity if he did.
Sure. Whether or not that will bother him, I don't know. But not getting his money will.
Can we get in trouble, though?
Yeah.
Well, to be honest, I'm not sure. I think we should get legal advice and keep the whole affair above board.
Well, how'd you go about it, Mr. Gorham?
Well, I believe we should draw up a statement of what we intend to do and why, and then send copies of it to the government housing authorities, the Veterans Administration, and any other federal and state agencies concerned, just to get ourselves on the record.
It's a good idea.
Very sound.
Now, after that, we pool our monthly mortgage statements and appoint one man to present them to Mr. Hobbs, to tell him that they won't be paid until our homes are made habitable and worth the purchase price agreed on. Now, that's the whole idea. Now, how do you feel about it?
Well, it's certainly better than just putting up with paying for these cracker boxes.
I'll go along with it.
I'm glad to hear that, Mr. Bradley.
Count me in.
And I'll make the first motion of this informal association that Andy Gorham be the man we appoint to talk to Mr. Clifford Hobbs. Huh?
All right, I will.
Second.
And I'll do my best to get more out of him than just conversation.
Counterspy headquarters. Yes, Mr. Secretary, I'll connect you. Counterspy headquarters. Busy, hold on, please. Yes, Mr. Harding.
Mr. Peters, please.
Mr. Peters, thank you.
Peters, you come into my office for a minute, Peters. Okay, Chief, and bring a copy of that memorandum from the Veterans Administration. Which one? That letter from the XGEIs who are refusing to honor their mortgage statements. Oh, yes. Be right in, Chief.
What do you think about it, Peter? Well, from the way they described their houses, Chief, I sympathize with them, but I don't see that there's anything we can do.
Oh, we could conduct an investigation.
Of what? There's no visible cause for criminal proceedings.
As I know, still two agencies have already called asking us to investigate.
Oh?
The Federal Housing Administration and the National Association of Home Builders.
Association of Home Builders? That's a private builder's outfit, isn't it?
Yes, reputable builders in all large cities.
Well, what's their interest in this?
Well, a story like this is bound to get publicity. The public will read that publicity, and they'll cast all contractors and home builders in the same role as this Oaknub Realty Company. They won't differentiate.
So the National Association wants to get on record as opposing these practices.
That's it.
And the FHA?
They don't think any outfit that can stir up as much resentment as this company did could be completely legitimate.
Then we do investigate.
I think we should, Peters. I want you to assign two agents to check the company's incorporation papers and any other related documents of public record.
Right, Chief.
Also get train reservations for us to Asheville. We'll question this man who signed this letter for the veterans, this Andrew Gorham.
Back to our old Nick, David Harding, counterspy case in a moment. Now, I want to tell you folks how you can get one of the most useful knives you've ever had in your home at a fraction of the price you'd expect to pay. It's a handy, helpful slicing knife, nearly 13 inches long, with a blade of gleaming lifetime stainless steel. And notice this especially. The blade is hollow ground. Now, if you know knives, you know that hollow grinding makes for a longer-lasting, keener edge. And you know it's a process which is usually found only in knives costing $2 or more. Yet, you can get this knife for only 25 cents, with two wrappers from either Old Nick or Bit of Honey candy bars. Yes, to get your stainless steel slicing knife, just send 25 cents in coin with two Old Nick or Bit of Honey wrappers to Old Nick, Box 144, New York 8, New York.
Old Nick, Box 144, New York 8, New York.
We can make this offer only because we have a special arrangement with a famous cutlery manufacturer. He is the only one in the country who has this new secret process by which long-lasting stainless steel can be successfully hollow ground. We guarantee that this stainless steel slicing knife would compare favorably with knives costing 75 cents to $1, even without the special process hollow grinding. But hollow grinding gives this knife longer life, a keener edge, and greater usefulness. So when you send in, you're really getting extra value, an outstanding bargain buy. But remember the address, Old Nick, Box 144, New York 8, New York. For each stainless steel slicing knife you want, send us two wrappers from either Old Nick or Bit of Honey candy bars and 25 cents in coin. The offer may be withdrawn at any time because the supply is limited. So be sure of your quick-cut slicing knife. Send your order today. Now, back to our Old Nick, David Harding, counterspy case.
Let's drop the act, Mr. Hobbs. You know perfectly well that not a single one of us is satisfied with this house.
I hope you didn't come in here just to argue.
No, Mr. Hobbs, I didn't. I came in to give you these. Here.
What are they?
A mortgage statement you mailed out a few days ago. All 45 of them.
What?
And until you do something about the condition of the Oak Nub homes, that's all you're going to get every month. Your statement's back again.
I'm not sure I understand.
It's simple enough, Mr. Hobbs. You either take care of the complaints we made about the houses, or we refuse to pay for
them. You can't do that. I'll foreclose on you.
If you'd like to make 45 foreclosures with the publicity that would result, go ahead.
I'll take you to court.
That may do some good. We'll find out in court.
Now, look here, Gorham. Isn't there some way we can get together on this thing?
Yes.
How?
Start repairs on the houses. All 45 of them.
Now, look. I can't spend the company's money on my own say-so. I've got investors and stockholders to think of.
And we've got families to think of. We paid for decent places to live, and we want them.
Now, why don't you be sensible about this, Gorham?
Just what do you consider sensible?
Well, you made a lot of complaints about your house. Suppose I take care of those complaints.
And the other houses in the development?
Forget them. Worry about yourself.
Well, that's an attractive offer.
I know a smart man when I see one.
Thanks. And I assure you I'm smart enough to know why you're making this offer.
What do you mean?
You're not impressed by me. You're impressed by the fact that I'm representing all of the homes you hold mortgages on. Well, I intend to keep it that way, since our only strength is in sticking together.
Now, Gorham, don't be a fool. I'll make my offer even more attractive. You listen to a deal.
Mr. Hobbs, the only deal I'll make will involve all 45 homeowners. When you're ready to talk one like that, call me up. Until then, you can whistle for your money. Goodbye.
Not a bad-looking house on the surface, Chief.
Take a closer look, Peters. Some of those clappards up there are warped.
Oh, I didn't notice.
Yes? Mr. Andrew Gorham? Oh, that's right. My name is David Harding. This is Mr. Harry Peters.
How do you do?
Oh, what can I do for you? Our credentials. From the United States Counterspy.
Oh, come in.
Thank you. I imagine you know why we're here.
Yes, I think so. Well, won't you sit down? Or isn't that the customary procedure before an arrest?
Arrest?
Oh, I think you've got us wrong, Mr. Gorham. We're here just to ask questions.
Oh, well, go right ahead. We want to stay within the law.
Well, Mr. Gorham, what do you expect to gain by this?
Decent homes and good repair. You weren't forced into buying this house, were you?
No, I know, Mr. Harding. Caveat emptor. Let the buyer beware. But in a tight market like housing, I think the seller should have some responsibility for what he sells.
You've got a point there.
When did you notice defects beginning to show up in your homes, Mr. Gorham?
4 or 5 months after they were built.
You notified the building company?
Yes, but they didn't pay any attention until we all got together.
Oh? You're getting results, then?
Well, not exactly results, but we've made Mr. Hobbs of the Oak Nub Company rather unhappy.
I should imagine he would be.
He offered to fix up my house and possibly throw in a little money if I'd forget the whole affair.
Just your house, not the others?
That's right.
Sounds a little off-key, doesn't it, Chief?
Yeah, I thought so, too.
If it were only faulty construction, Hobbs could take the case to civil court and make some kind of an adjustment that would be fair all around.
Yes, if he's an honest man. Well, I know of nothing that could prove he isn't.
Well, I don't think a man who was on the level would have tried to buy you off.
I agree, Mr. Peters. Mr. Gorham, what did you pay for this house?
$10,500.
Are all the houses in the development the same price?
No, they run from 9.5 to 12.5.
I see. Well, I'd like to run tests of the structural defects in a few of these homes, have a responsible builder look them over. Do you think that'd be all right with your neighbors?
I'm sure it would, Mr. Harding. We'll agree to anything to get some action.
You set that up, will you, Peters?
Right, Chief.
And, Mr. Gorham, if Mr. Hobbs should get in touch with you with another personal offer, let me know.
All right, Mr. Harding.
I can't guarantee results, but I can guarantee you that we'll make a thorough investigation of this whole affair.
Hello, Bernie.
Oh, Hobbs.
Mr. Mankato up yet?
Yeah, he's having breakfast in bed.
Well, I have to see him right away.
He won't like that.
Neither do I, but there's a little trouble.
Trouble? I thought this setup was strictly legitimate.
Well, things go wrong.
And we put them right.
And I hope you can.
What is it, Barney? Who was it?
Hobbs, he wants to see you.
I'm sorry to disturb you at this time, Mr. Mankato.
Okay, you did. What's on your mind? You got a simple job? There ought to be no problems.
I'm afraid there are, though.
What's so hard about collecting the mortgages I hold?
Simply, they won't pay.
What?
They're beginning to get wise to the fact that they were stuck with those houses.
I'll shed a tear for them. They bought them, they'll pay for them. Strictly legitimate.
You want the case to get to court?
Ain't gonna get there. They're gonna pay.
Not according to Andy Gorham.
Who's he?
One of the men who bought a house. He's representing them all.
Troublemaker, huh?
Well, he's not easy to get along with.
We'll see about that. Barney.
Yeah.
I advise you to be cautious, Mr. Mankato.
Keep your advice. All my dough is tied up in those houses. Money I got the hard way. Rum running in the 20s, policies in the 30s. Black markets during the war. Gonna keep it the hard way if I have to.
Well, times have changed, Mr. Mankato. People have different ideas nowadays.
Nothing changes. People are the same. They only wear different clothes. You push them around, they do like you say. I push.
Yeah? Gorham won't be easy. I tried to buy him off. He wouldn't sell.
One of those guys, eh? Barney knows how to handle them.
He'll still have the others to deal with.
Don't be a jerk. Barney, you were with me in that poultry racket in the Bronx.
Yeah.
What happens when you chop a chicken's head off?
He kicks a little and he dies.
Get the idea, Hobbs?
Don't be too hasty about this, Mr. Mankato.
Who's being hasty? Barney picks this guy up. We try to reason with him. If he don't reason, it's his tough luck that he's the head of the chicken. The part that gets chopped off.
Well, that fills in the picture with more to... Right. Goodbye.
Hello, Chief. I've got something real interesting for you.
I've got something more than interesting. Criminal.
What? I've been over to the local FHA office getting information via teletype from their Washington headquarters.
You can pin something on the realty company?
A false statement in their building application to the government. They said those homes they built wouldn't sell for more than $7,500. That's how they got their application approved.
I'm not surprised.
Why? What have you got?
Chief, do you know who holds 90% of the company?
Who?
Mr. Christopher Mankato.
Chris Mankato, the racketeer who said he was going to retire?
That's the one. Only he doesn't seem to have kept his promise.
No, at the prices he sold those houses, his profit's 200%.
That's a racket in anybody's language.
We'll close in fast, Peters. So far, the company hasn't any idea that we're investigating. We should be able to attach all their files and records for criminal and civil prosecution.
What do we go for, Mankato or Hobbs?
Well, first, Hobbs. He signed the building application. He'll lead us to Mankato.
What about Andy Gorham, Chief?
Ask him to come down here. Start him on a full statement of the whole affair. I'll pay a little visit to Mr. Hobbs.
Mr. Harding, I had no idea your organization would be involved in this. It's a very unfortunate situation.
I'm sure it is.
Oh, I can see the viewpoint of Mr. Gorham and the rest of the homeowners, but, well, I have my stockholders to look out for.
And who are they?
Why, various people. I can't name them all offhand.
You go to great lengths to show your stockholders a profit, don't you, Mr. Hobbs?
What do you mean?
I have a copy of a building application you made to the government.
Oh.
You said those houses would sell for $7,500. You charged more than that.
Why?
A false statement is a serious offense, Mr. Hobbs. A prison sentence goes with it.
Well, I don't...
Never mind. I'll take that. Just sit where you are. Hello?
Open up, Realty Company.
Oh, yes, Peter.
Oh, Chief.
What is it?
I can't locate Gorham.
What?
He left his office to go to lunch. He didn't come back, and he hasn't gone home. I don't like it, Chief. Particularly since Mankato's involved.
We'll find out if he's got anything to do with Gorham's disappearance soon enough. Come over here right away.
You've got Hobbs there?
I have. And I'll give you odds that he tells me everything we want to know before you arrive, including where Mankato is. Won't you, Mr. Hobbs?
You know, you're being silly, kid. You ought to listen to reason.
What's your interest in this?
Don't be curious. Just be smart. Say the word and you go out of here with a new house and a couple of bucks.
Well, suppose I did. You think the rest of the fellas would pay off and take it lying down?
I'll worry about that. You take away the head, you take away the power. See the deal?
No.
Okay, Barney.
Yeah, sure.
Jake, kid, Barney's hand can hold out longer than your face.
Yeah?
Well, you won't get away with this.
The original kid. Everybody says that. One last time. Is it a deal?
No.
Too bad. But in a way, it's good. You saved me some dough. Looks like you do a real job, Barney.
Okay. Here or someplace else?
Someplace else. I don't like funerals.
All right. What do you mean? You're not going to...
Knock you off? Yeah, kid. You're object lesson number one. Nobody likes to die, and they might think twice about kicking up a fuss with you as an example.
Let's can the chatter, Chris, and get it over with, huh?
Your department, Barney.
Yeah.
Open up, Mankato. Open up!
Somebody crossed this boss.
Stay where you are.
Oh, Mr. Harding.
Untie him, Peter.
Right, Chief.
Harding, the counterspies, huh?
That's right, Mankato. Easy, Barney. I wouldn't like to shoot you.
All right, Andy. Well, a little bit worse for the wear. I'm glad you came, and that's an understatement.
All right, Peters, put cuffs on Mankato and Barney.
Okay, nobody's going to make trouble. I got lawyers.
You'll need them. What happened, Gorham?
Now, that gorilla Barney picked me up. I didn't know what it was all about.
Mankato's the man behind the Oaknub Real Estate Company. That's his interest.
Yeah, and by rights, I should be suing this guy. He's the one who's not paying off. I just wanted to save the courts a lot of trouble.
That's nice of you, Mankato, but I'm sure they'll find it no trouble at all to convict you of false statements and fraud. Take them away, Peters.
Mr. Harding will be back in a moment with a special guest. You know, friends, I want to be sure that every counterspy listener has a chance to get one of our outstanding stainless steel slicing knives. So if the lady of the house isn't listening now, be sure you tell her about this offer. Or better still, send in for one for her. Remember, this is an extra useful slicing knife, guaranteed to compare with knives costing 75 cents to $1. Because of a new secret process, we've been able to have this knife hollow ground, a feature usually found only in knives costing $2 or more. But this slicing knife is offered to you today for only a quarter, with two wrappers from Old Mick or Bit of Honey candy bars.
Our slicing knife has a blade that is gleaming stainless steel, hollow ground with a razor-sharp edge, hollow ground by a special exclusive process to keep its sharpness for a long, long time.
The handle is polished blonde hardwood designed to fit your hands smoothly and comfortably with a non-slip grip.
You'll be proud to use it as a carving knife at your nicest dinner party.
And your stainless steel slicing knife will stand up for years of hardest kitchenware. It's stronger, it's extra sharp, it's extra useful. You may want two of these fine knives, so here's what to do. For each stainless steel slicing knife you want, send in two Old Mick or Bit of Honey wrappers with 25 cents. Please use coin. Do not use stamps or checks. Send to Old Mick, Box 144, New York 8, New York.
Old Mick, Box 144, New York 8, New York.
Send your order now while you're still thinking about it. The quantity is limited, so send in today.
This is David Harding. Now we're happy to present the Executive Vice President of the National Association of Home Builders, Mr. Frank W. Cordwright.
The moral of tonight's episode is an important one. Don't buy a new home without knowing everything about it. Unfortunately, some fly-by-night operators, like the ones you've just heard dramatized, have tried to capitalize on the immense housing demand. In order to drive these unscrupulous people out of the home building business, we must have the help of the home-buying public. Your part of the job is to be sure you're buying good value and quality. Be sure that the home is well-constructed and well-situated, that it is properly priced and financed, and that it is being built and sold by a reputable builder. These are all easy things to learn before buying a house, things that one generally makes very sure of before buying many less expensive things. Remember this. Home building requires skill, integrity, and years of experience. We came out of the war with a most serious housing shortage. But by this time, we are approaching the 2 million mark and are beginning to meet the most critical part of the veterans' housing needs. Speaking for the National Association of Home Builders, I can assure you that its many thousands of members will continue to build good houses at fair prices.
Thank you, Mr. Cordwright.
In next Sunday, same time, same station, for the case of the photogenic crook,
whose gang dealt in hot money until the counterspies worked out a scheme to put their activities on ice. The case of the camera-happy crook on David Harding, Counterspy. Tonight's David Harding Counterspy case was directed by William M. Sweets and was dramatized by Palmer Thompson, with music by Jesse Crawford, and featured Don MacLaughlin and Mandel Kramer. David Harding Counterspy is a Phillips H. Lord production, originating in New York for the makers of Old Nick and Bit of Honey candy bars. Now, a listening reminder. When Drew Pearson looks ahead, he usually comes out with a fascinating prediction. Be sure to hear Pearson tonight over this ABC station. This is ABC, the American Broadcasting Company.
While Bit O' Honey was recently revived, it appears that Old Nick passed away in the 1960s. It was a bar of fudge and nuts coated in milk chocolate, and its advert featured the tagline, America's Favorite Candy Bar. Alrighty, that's a little bit about Old Nick. And that's David Harding, Counterspy, from 76 years ago, May 23rd, 1948, here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. We'll go to a prequel, and it will be Orson Welles and the Lives of Harry Lime from 72 years ago.
Civil defense information. This is basic civil defense information from the Department of Defense, Office of Civil Defense, Washington. When a nuclear bomb or missile explodes near the ground, great quantities of earth and debris are sucked up into the fireball and carried by the prevailing winds before falling back to earth. This material is radioactive fallout. The particles look like grains of salt or sand. Fallout gives off invisible gamma rays like X-rays, and heavy exposure to it can cause serious radiation sickness, even death. If a person receives a small or medium dose of radiation, his body will repair itself and he will get well. Usually, the effects of radiation from fallout are more severe in very young and very old persons and those not in good health. Radiation sickness is not contagious. The most dangerous period is the first 24 hours after fallout arrives, but you might have to use fallout shelter up to 2 weeks. For further information about fallout and how you can protect yourself against it, consult your local civil defense office.
Now on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox, an episode of The Lives of Harry Lime, the prequel to the motion picture The Third Man. Orson Welles, as Harry Lime, was killed in the picture. That's why these events take place before the picture. This episode is from 72 years ago, May 23rd, 1952, and it is Murder on the Riviera.
Presenting Orson Welles as The Third Man. The Lives of Harry Lime. The fabulous stories of the immortal character, originally created in the story The Third Man, with zither music by Anton Karas.
This little story of frustrated love and violent death just happened to happen on the Côte d'Azur. It might have happened somewhere else, but no. This little strip of Italian and French coastline called the Riviera is where it all took place. The story begins at dawn, the lovely, tender, early dawn of a summer's day in 1946. At this period of my career, I was in the cigarette business, American cigarettes. My end of it was distribution, which in France was organized out of Marseille. That's where I was bound on this particular morning. I had a full truckload of the four leading brands disguised in cans of powdered milk, and I'd crossed the border, never mind how, while it was still dark. And by 6 o'clock, I'd passed through Monte Carlo. I figure I was somewhere just outside of Villefranche when I saw her. She was young, red-headed. She was standing behind a big limousine trying to push it, and she was wearing an evening dress. I slowed up. She seemed to be having trouble. Car wasn't budging. She's a very beautiful girl. So I stopped, got out of the truck. I could see she was frightened. I went over to the car she'd been trying to push. There was a man sitting inside. I could see he was wearing a dinner jacket. He had on black horn-rimmed glasses, and he was bald. None of which would have been very interesting, except that he was also dead. Well, that's how it began. Stick around. I'll tell you how it ended.
And now, Orson Welles as Harry Lime, the third man, in today's story, Murder on the Riviera.
Well, I went back to my truck and turned it around. Don't ask me why, I'm just telling you what I did. I moved the truck up behind the car. She was still standing there in the road looking at me. Hey, you! You're stupid, aren't you? She didn't answer me. Well, you must be stupid. Don't you know enough to take off the brake? All at once, she understood, ran back up the road to the car, opened the door, and released the brake. Before I knew it, the car was teetering over the edge of the road. Then, with a lurch, it slipped down the embankment into the sea. She just stood there, looking at me. Well, what are you going to do now?
I don't know.
Well, where are you going?
I don't know.
Well, you can't just stand there. The day's starting. People are waking up. There's going to be traffic. Come here.
What do you want?
Well, suppose I give you a lift. You'd be a good girl if I do. Remember, I've got the gun. What's your name?
Danielle. People call me Danny.
Well, I'll call you stupid. Come on, get in and close the door, stupid. Better be on our way.
Thank you. What's your name?
Harry. You know where I'm taking you?
Police?
I live in Nice, stupid. This is 10 kilometers away from here. We're going home. I had a room in Nice over a cafe, nothing very grand, but convenient. I guess it was that evening dress that did it, but I found myself apologizing as I opened the door. This isn't your style, my lady, I'm sure, but you have to put up with it for a while. You know, bachelor's quarters. Hey.
Hello, Harry.
Now, look here. What's all this?
Well, I didn't know you'd be back so soon.
Oh, you didn't.
Perhaps you'd better introduce us, Harry.
Well, this is Lily, Danny. Danny, this is Lily.
I'm sorry, Harry. Don't look so upset. I know how you feel.
How I feel?
You see, I thought you'd be up in Genoa for another couple of days, and by then I'd found some place to stay. The old woman downstairs let me in.
Come on, come on. Get your things on now and go.
Go? Go where?
It's a nice day. Go take a swim.
Well, I don't have a bathing suit.
Here.
What's that?
2,000 francs.
Why are you giving it to me?
Go out and buy yourself a bathing suit.
Goodbye. There's something I've got to explain.
All right, start talking, but make it fast. Remember what I told you before. Make it good.
Well, the first thing is, I've got to get to Paris.
Well, if you think I'm going to drive you there in the truck.
No, of course not. Here.
What am I supposed to do with that?
It's the key to my room in the hotel.
What about it?
Well, I can't spend the rest of my life in an evening dress, can I? Besides, I've got to have my passport.
Try to get out of the country, is
well,
that it?
Paris first. I told you. That's where the money is. Then we'll see.
Well, then we'll... What do you mean, we?
That's up to you.
Hmm. So I'm supposed to check you out of the hotel, is that it?
Well, just put a few things in a bag. You know, things I can wear in the day. Oh, and remember the passport. It's in the drawer by the bed.
Is that what you wanted to tell me?
Why, yes.
I thought maybe you were going to do some explaining.
Explaining?
Yes, there was a body in that car. Didn't you notice?
You don't think I killed him, do you?
Well, I don't think he shot himself.
Well, why not? Why shouldn't he?
You know what I ought to do with you? I ought to turn you in right now.
We've been gambling all night. He'd lost heavily. He was desperate.
Stop pawing me. You know what probation is.
Probation?
It's what you're on, stupid. You needed help. The idea was I'd give you a chance to explain things to me first instead of the cops. Well, you've had your chance.
Give me a cigarette.
Here, take these. I'll get some more.
Harry, when you leave the hotel, you better go by the service entrance. And remember the plane tickets.
Yeah, the what? The plane tickets?
For Paris. You'll have to buy them.
Let's get back to cases now.
Who was he?
Who?
The stiff. Who do you think? I mean, the dead body.
I don't know.
Well, how did you happen to be in his car?
Oh, he offered to take me. It was late, remember? It was dawn. We'd been gambling in the casino all night.
And you didn't know him?
Well, I was just sitting next to him at the table. He staked me for a while, but he started losing himself and he wouldn't let me go. He said something about changing his luck.
Well, how did he get you in his car?
Oh, it was only a lift home. Oh. We were both going the same way.
Well, we aren't. We're going separate ways. But first, I'll get you a bag and passport. Goodbye, stupid. My truck, packed full of smuggled cigarettes, was waiting in the street below. I couldn't leave it there in full daylight. I should have taken it on to Marseille, but I couldn't do that and still go back to Monte Carlo to Danny's hotel. I went to the airport first, but this being the holiday time in France, there wasn't any space, so then I drove over to the railway station and booked a seat on the blue train for Paris that night. And when I came out of the station, I found Lily waiting in the truck.
Hello, Harry.
Oh, I wish you'd take my suggestion, Lily, and go swimming. I've got enough troubles.
Are you leaving for good,
Harry? Right now, I'm going to Monte Carlo. Where are you going?
To Monte Carlo.
I'm a liar.
Why is that, Harry?
I told somebody this morning I liked girls.
Well, you do. You like them too much.
Lily was a nice kid, but she wasn't making life any easier for me that day. I tried to talk her out of tagging along with me, but it wasn't any use. Lily, will you please tell me just why you're taking this long ride to Monte Carlo?
I was just going to ask you the same question.
All right, I'll answer it, because somebody's in trouble.
Oh, what did she do?
You keep jumping to conclusions. Why are you so sure that she did something? I said she was in trouble.
That's how you get into trouble, isn't it? By doing things.
Well, not necessarily. Look at you.
I am not in trouble, Harry. You want me to be.
When you lost your job, that's trouble enough. You didn't do anything. They just fired you.
Well, I threw a gin face at a man and hit him with it.
Glass and all?
Glass and all. I guess that's doing something.
I guess so. Well, now what?
You mean about me?
Yeah.
Well, it's nothing working in those chip little plans.
Gonna try for something better?
You've seen my act, Harry. The dance of the sacred flame.
Yes.
It's lousy, isn't it?
Pretty lousy.
Well, it isn't going to get very much better. To be a dancer, I figure a girl ought to be able to dance.
Not with your equipment, Harry.
You like me, Harry?
You mean, do I like the way you look?
Well, do you?
Well, I like the way you look, but you're wasting your time, honey, if you're thinking of marriage or anything like that. I'm not the type.
Oh, yes, you're the type. You're just not in the mood. What's wrong with that girl? Why are you hiding her?
If I tell you, I wonder, would you help?
I'd help you.
No, I guess not. No, you wouldn't help her.
Well, why should I? And come to that, why should you?
Well, I get a funny reaction when people are in trouble, Lily. I guess because I've been in so much trouble myself, but I never changed. I have to help them first before I ask any questions. Besides, I don't like policemen.
What have the police got to do
Nothing,
with it?
Nothing, I was just talking. Look, if a bird flew in your window, what would you do?
I'd be scared.
Why?
Because I'm superstitious. When a bird comes into the house, it means death.
Okay, let's forget birds. Are you superstitious about mice?
What are you trying to say?
I'm trying to explain a point of view. Now, tell me this. Have you ever let a mouse out of a trap?
You mean a mouse in an evening dress by Jacques Fatt?
All right now, Lily. I'm leaving you here. Wait for me if you want to. This is the service entrance to the hotel.
Well, what if it is?
Well, they'd stop me at the front. Here, hold my coat.
And just what do I do with it?
Just hold it. Hold it and wait. I'm going to be an electrician or a plumber. I haven't decided which. In shirt sleeves, I've got a better chance of getting up to a hotel room without anybody stopping me.
Yes, but...
You wanted to help, didn't you? I went into the hotel. In my hurry, I forgot that in that coat I'd given Lily, there was the gun. Not my gun, the one that fell out of the car of the dead man. Don't know why I didn't think of it, but then I don't know what I was thinking of that whole day. 407 was the number of the key. I went up there as quietly as I could, let myself in. And on a drawer by the bed, I found Danny's passport. It identified her as Madame Danielle Savich. I put the passport in my pocket, opened up the smallest of her bags, and started hurriedly throwing some things into it. In the closet, I found a tailored suit. I picked out some shoes, thought it would match, threw the whole thing into the bag. I figured she'd need something from the dressing table, makeup, things like that, and... That's when I noticed the leather folder, one of those things for photographs. It had slipped to the floor, and it opened. I looked down at it. There were two pictures, each showing Danny and a man. The same man. In one pose, they were in ski togs, and in the other, in bathing suits. He was bald, with heavy black horn-rimmed glasses, and I recognized him. He was the dead man from the car. At this moment, there was the sound of a key turning in the lock of the door. I jumped to my feet, dropping the toilet articles, reached the door in a single leap, and turned the bolt.
All right, open up in there.
I didn't answer that. There didn't seem to be much point in getting into conversation. I looked wildly around for some means of hiding or escape.
Open up! You'll only make it harder for yourself if you don't. This is the police!
In a moment, Orson Welles returns as Harry Lime, the third man. And now, Orson Welles, as Harry Lime, the third man, continues today's story, Murder on the Riviera.
Open up in there! This is the police!
I rushed to the window. It was locked. I kicked it open. There was a balcony on the floor below. It was quite a drop. But in another minute, I knew they'd succeed in battering down the door, so I risked it and managed to drop safely enough on the narrow terrace. That jump had only been a matter of some 12 or 15 feet, but it was four stories between the balcony and the street. My idea was to try climbing into one of the other rooms and getting out that way. I pushed my hand in and turned the catch inside, but this, a very fierce-looking old dowager in corsets, appeared and scared me away, and I ran to the next window, and that was open. I jumped into the room where a very pretty girl without very much on, and whom I'm sorry to say I never saw again in my life, was giving herself a pedicure. She looked startled, but I didn't pause for explanations. I rushed to the door of her room and bolted out into the hall. Then she started to scream.
Help! Murder! Police! Police!
I started toward the stairway, but I could see some police and an assorted gaggle of bellhops and porters converging on my floor from above and below, so I turned on my heels and raced down the hall, trying the doors of the various rooms. Finally, I found one that wasn't locked and let myself in, slamming the door and bolting it behind me. I picked up the phone. Hello? Mayor Bessie's? Does Patrice happen to be there? Well, put him on the phone. I figured the best thing to do was to get my friend, who happened to be a croupier in the casino, we used to hang out at this restaurant that I'd called, to bring me a change of clothes over to the hotel room. If I could look enough like a tourist going down to the beach, maybe I could get out past the cops. Well, Patrice, the croupier, was a real friend. He arrived with sunglasses, a jersey pullover, a beach robe, and a low comedy blue canvas hat. And in that outfit, I managed to ride down in the elevator without attracting overmuch attention. At the side of the hotel, however, I found a gang of cops gathered by my truck. They were unloading the cans of powdered milk and prying them open. So that was goodbye to the truck, goodbye to a very expensive shipment of smuggled cigarettes, and maybe also goodbye to Harry Lime. As casually as possible, I strolled around to the front and ordered a cab. Lily was nowhere in sight. That was something to be grateful for. 40 minutes later, I was back home in Nice. Not, I can assure you, in a very cheerful frame of mind. For one thing, the door of my room was locked. And for another, my croupier friend, Patrice, had told me that some sportsman spearing underwater for fish had come on the car. The bald man had been found and identified. His name was Victor Savage.
Yes?
Okay, stupid, let me in.
Oh, it's you.
Better let me in, Mrs. Savage.
Oh.
It's not much of a welcome. Hey, what are you doing?
Thank you, Harry, that was nice. What do you dress like that for, Harry?
Well,
What have you been doing all this time?
What have I been doing? Well, nothing much.
Hey! Where's my bag?
Oh, I forgot it.
You what?
Well, you might say I was occupied. It sort of slipped my mind.
But all I've got is that evening dress. I can't stay here forever.
Honey, you're not going to.
But Harry.
Yes?
Don't you realize I'm a fugitive from justice?
That makes two of us stupid. The only difference is if they catch me, I'll have to serve some time.
What for?
Breaking and entering, for one thing. Aiding and abetting a murderer, burglary, and impersonating a tourist.
Oh, you're joking.
Besides, why will it be you that's in jail and not me?
This is France. You're a good-looking dame, and that's useful anywhere.
What are you talking about?
Just this, stupid. If you can make that shooting of yours look just a little bit like a crime of passion, you've maybe got a chance. But you better start telling the truth just to get into the habit.
I just thought of something.
Congratulations.
When you were knocking on the door...
Yes?
What was it you called me?
Well, what do you think I called you?
Well, I don't know. I guess I was dreaming.
I called you by your married name, Mrs. Savage.
Well, that means you found my passport.
Yes. Some people went swimming today and found your husband,
what?
Too. Yes, Victor Savage, Esquire. He was wearing a black tie and very little hair, and he was sitting in a 1939 Humber Snipe, black with blue trimmings, about 30 feet underwater. And I warn you, Mrs. Savage, that anything you say will be used against you.
I don't like your jokes.
I don't like them much either. Want to make up some of your own? Oh, that's...
Did you forget something else besides my bag?
I don't have any cigarettes.
Wait a minute. I know something else you forgot. You had it in the pocket of your coat.
The gun.
Yes.
Pretty little thing, too. Still, by now, I should think you'd be tired of playing with it.
My fingerprints.
Listen, stupid. Savage's body is identified. You're Mrs. Savage, and half the casino must have seen you two driving off together. Forget about the fingerprints and get to work dreaming up that other woman.
What other woman?
The one he was cheating you with. When you found out about it, everything went red, remember? And before you knew it, you'd pulled the trigger.
But that isn't what happened at all.
Okay. Tell it your own way.
Well, you see...
Don't try it on me, stupid. Wait till they catch you. I've had all I can take.
Hey.
Yes?
Nothing, I guess, but... What are you doing?
I'm changing my clothes, stupid. There's a tuxedo I borrowed from downstairs.
But why? Why get dressed up for the evening?
I don't know what's worse, your questions or your answers. Listen, stupid, have you forgotten that all you've got to travel in is an evening dress? I've got to get you from here to the station. This is summer. It'll still be light. But with me in the tuxedo, you stand a better chance of not being noticed. Maybe they'll think we're going to a ball.
And what happens when I get to Paris in the morning?
Well, you've got money in Paris, remember?
Harry.
What is it now?
I don't really have any money there, Harry. I just said that.
Well, I'm in it this far. Okay, how much can you get by with?
How much?
Now, I know you're stupid. Money, of course. How much money?
But I've got money.
Yeah?
Well, certainly. I've got 15 million francs.
What?
Well, right here in my bag. It's what he won.
Your husband?
My ex-husband.
You didn't mention a divorce.
You didn't ask.
Then what were the two of you doing in Monte Carlo together?
We just happened to meet at the casino, and then he started to win.
Go on.
He wouldn't let me go because he was afraid it might change his luck. You know how gamblers
are. So then you changed his luck for him.
Well, no, I didn't play at all. Harry.
Okay, stupid. Okay, keep your distance.
I don't think I like you.
We'll go into that later. When did your husband start to lose?
Well, he didn't. He just went on winning. He didn't lose at all. I just said
that. Why, for goodness sake, did you lie about that?
Because of the money. The 15 million francs. Your tie's crooked.
I told you to keep your distance.
And I told you I didn't like him. But I just said that.
Tell me more about the money.
Oh, don't be so mercenary. I want you to kiss me.
I'd rather talk about the money, the 15 million francs, remember?
That's quite a lot, isn't it?
I guess it was enough.
Well, you see, now that Victor and I were getting divorced, I thought they might decide it wasn't mine. Well, you know, when they found him.
Listen, you sexy little monster. It's just 15 minutes to train time. You're not going to get far, you know. The only reason I'm doing this is because I'm just a little bit cracked.
You're not anything of the sort.
I'm the kind of fellow who refuses jury duty in a murder trial and lets mice out of traps. You're going to get it, stupid. They'll catch you. It just isn't going to be me that turns you in.
By the way, where's the gun?
Lily has it.
Lily?
You met her this morning. I better get it back or she'll hawk it. She got fired out of her job and she's broke.
Oh, she's pretty. She'll get by. What do you want with the gun?
I thought I'd throw it in the Mediterranean, stupid. Guns can be traced, you know.
Well, it wasn't my gun, Harry. It was his. He kept it in the glove compartment.
So he took it out of the glove compartment and shot him dead with it, just like that,
No, Harry, not just like that. Not like that at all. Do you honestly think it happened that way? Why, Harry, what reason would I have?
15 million francs is a pretty good reason, honey. He didn't feel like giving it to you, is that it? So you settled the argument with a couple of bullets.
Harry!
Well...
If that's what you really think, well, I guess there isn't any point in our talking about it anymore.
No, honey, I guess there isn't. Take your money and let's get out of here. I got her to the station, okay, and into a compartment. She told me she was hungry. There were a couple of minutes to spare, so I went across the way to get her something to eat. On the way back, I found Lily waiting on the platform. What are you doing here?
Seeing you off.
I'm not going anywhere. Hey, I just thought, give me back that gun, Lily.
You don't need it.
I don't need it. I don't even want it. But neither do you, and you're better off without it. Come on, give.
Harry?
Yes?
Why are you going back to her now? Can't you leave her alone?
Got a ticket.
Is that all? you're sure.
No, I'm not sure. I just wish...
What?
Well, I wish I had a better idea of what she's really like.
Shall I tell you? No, you wouldn't believe me. Here's the gun. If you decide to go to Paris, Harry, send me a postcard.
Why, Harry!
Hello.
I thought I'd seen the last of
You're
you.
You're going to, honey, in another 20 seconds. Here, there's a little beef stew from the restaurant across the way. Here's some wine.
Oh, you're
Goodbye.
An angel.
Oh, stop it.
Stop what?
Make it with the big blue eyes. Tell me what happened in that car. Or don't. That's up to you, but quit the kidding.
Well, what's the use? You won't believe me.
Nobody seems to think I'll believe them. Why don't you try?
Well, what really happened is this. He owed me the money, and I tried to get it away from him. It was really mine, you see, mine by rights.
Yes.
Then we started struggling, and before I knew it, Look! There, out of the window.
I turned. On the platform outside, we could see a crowd of police. I recognized some of them. They were the cops who found my truck full of cigarettes. They must have followed.
So you did it! After all, you told the police!
No, Danny, I didn't. I didn't tell anybody. I swear I didn't. Hey, what are you doing?
Well, I thought I felt a gun in your pocket. Give it back to me!
Don't be a fool! Give me that gun. They're not coming after
Oh, yes,
you!
Yes, they are. You told them. You trapped me!
Danny! The next minute, the compartment was swarming with cops. They grabbed her and got the gun away from her. But that didn't do me much good. I had a nasty wound in the shoulder.
Take the woman away. Lime, you're under arrest. But first, we'll get you a doctor.
Well, Danny, at least I know now that your last story was the truth.
What story? What did she tell you?
She tried to hold up Savage with a gun. When he grabbed for it, she pulled the trigger. Reflex action problem.
Reflex?
I couldn't help it, Harry. I just couldn't. I saw the gun sticking out of your pocket.
Come on, take her out and give this man air. He's wounded.
Goodbye, Harry.
Goodbye, stupid.
No, let me through.
Yeah, what's this? There's another girl. What's she doing here?
Harry!
It was Lily down on the platform waving to me through the glass.
Send that girl away!
No use, officer. I've tried, but I guess I'm stuck with her.
Harry, speak to me, Harry!
I won't be using my room for a while. They'll be taking me to a hospital, and after that to jail. You can move in, Lily, if you want to.
Lily? Lily who?
Oh, just Lily. She's a nice girl, officer. But she's stupid, too.
Harry Lime returns in just a moment. And now, Harry Lime.
So here I am, in the hospital. But the doctor says I'll soon be up and around. Maybe around is the wrong word. The up part of it is more accurate. Up on a charge of cigarette smuggling. Well, I guess that's all for now. By the way, don't let this sad little tale of frustrated love and violent death keep you from taking a holiday on the Riviera. Murders don't happen here any more often than anywhere else. And generally speaking, in this part of the world, love doesn't get frustrated. Just keep your powder dry and look out for that moon. It's loaded. So long now.
And there you have it, from 72 years ago, May 23rd, 1952, Orson Welles and the Lives of Harry Lime here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Up tomorrow will be Dragnet, Night Watch, Suspense with Agnes Moorhead, Mr. District Attorney, and Claudia. But right now, Superman.
This is Dennis James. Here is Leo A. Hoy, Director of the Office of Civil and Defense Mobilization, who has a message for you about the importance of a home shelter for survival in the nuclear age.
Even though tomorrow's weapon delivery systems will travel at fantastic speeds, there will always be time to seek shelter from fallout. The important thing is you must have a shelter ready before attack. An underground shelter will give you excellent protection from fallout. Your basement will offer good protection if windows and walls are properly shielded. To help you build your fallout shelter, the Office of Civil and Defense Mobilization has prepared a detailed publication called Family Fallout Shelter. For your free copy, write to Post Office Box, Home Shelter, Battle Creek, Michigan, or contact your local civil defense office.
And check out civildefensemuseum.com for more information. Now, an episode of Superman, as we start wrapping up the Grayson Submarine matter, this episode from 83 years ago, May 23rd, 1941.
Presenting the transcription feature, Superman!
Look, up in the sky!
It's a bird, it's a plane,
it's Superman! Yes, it's Superman, strange visitor from the planet Krypton, who came to Earth with powers and abilities far beyond those of mortal men. Superman, who can leap tall buildings at a single bound, race a speeding bullet to its target, bend steel in his bare hands, and who, disguised as Clark Kent, mild-mannered reporter for a great metropolitan newspaper, fights a never-ending battle for truth and justice.
And now to our story. Well, it looked for a while as if Dr. Deutch and his gang of spies were going to succeed in their attempt to deliver the Grayson submarine into the hands of a foreign power. The finest undersea boat in the world was well into the Atlantic, but not too far away for Superman. The mighty visitor from the planet Krypton found the submarine and returned it safely to the naval base with its captain and crew unharmed. Dr. Deutch and his accomplice Hans were taken prisoner. And then, just as they were about to face punishment for their crimes, not the least of which was the murder of the submarine's designer, Walter Grayson, they managed to break loose. Dr. Deutch and Hans are free once more to work their evil against peace and freedom. Where will they strike first? At the moment, they are speeding away from the naval base in a stolen car.
Faster, Hans. Faster. By this time, they know we have escaped and they're after us.
Yeah, Doctor, but these holes are dangerous. There are too many curves. You see?
Don't worry, Hans. This car was built to travel at high speed. It is an official car.
How did it happen to be ready for our escape?
It did not happen, Hans. It was arranged. You will learn in this business, if you live long enough, never to trust to luck.
Who arranged it, Herr Doctor?
We had a very good friend at the naval base. A very good friend. Don't ask me who it is. There's something even you cannot know.
Yeah, Herr Doctor.
Now, to the right, it's the next crossroad, up ahead.
Where are we going, Herr Doctor?
Back to the old hideout. That's the ocean road.
But we can't do that. They will no doubt be watching for us.
Turn, you fool. Don't ever do that again, Hans. Remember, I give orders. You obey.
Yeah, Herr Doctor, but I told
you. You're not supposed to think. Go faster.
May I ask a question, Herr Doctor?
What is it?
Why are we going back to that house on the cliff?
In the first case, Hans, we are not going back to the house.
But where are we going?
Slow down. Now, look along the shoreline of the cove where we had the Grayson submarine anchored.
Yeah?
You see that small shack almost hidden in the woods near the shore?
Yeah. Yeah, I see it.
That is where we are going. Stupid police will have the house and the cliff guarded, of course. But they will never think to look in the shack.
But what is in the shack, Herr Doctor?
You will see. Turn in this dirt road.
I do not like this, Herr Doctor. We are too close to danger.
Whether or not you like it is of small importance. Have you forgotten that you took the oath to work on the master plan? Have you forgotten that those who took the oath swear that they would make the master plan succeed or die in the attempt?
No. No, I have not forgotten.
The Grayson submarine was nothing. It is the master plan that counts. The plan to rule the world. Stop the car. We'll walk the rest of the day.
Yeah. What are we going to do with the car?
I will show you. Get out. Close the door. Turn the front wheels toward the water. Now, get behind here with me and push.
And the car will roll into the water, Herr Doctor.
To be precise, Hans, into 30 feet of water.
But what will we do without a car?
Leave that to me. Now,
I... Smile. Try. Push. It is rolling. pulling.
Push harder.
Yeah, harder.
Now, let it go.
It sinks faster, Doctor.
Yeah, the inside is already filled up.
Now only the top shows.
Yeah, Hans, now she is gone, not even a bubble.
You'll never find it down there.
You are quite right. The sea hides many things. Now, Hans, I will show you why we have come to this shack. Look over there. What do you see?
A line of telephone posts.
Yes. Marching like soldiers over the hill, eh? Then suddenly, halfway down the hill, the poles stop.
Why here, Doctor?
Because from that point on, the telephone wires go underground through a cable.
Oh.
And that cable, Hans, is directly under the shed. And where do you think those telephone wires come from?
I do not know, Herr Doctor.
From the naval base, Hans. From the naval base.
Ah, I am beginning to understand. We will listen in.
Precisely, Hans. He, how do you say it, will tap the wires. He will hear all the conversations. He will see nothing, but he will hear everything.
Wunderbar, Herr Doctor. Wunderbar.
Wait until you have seen what's inside the shack. You will be amazed. Come, Hans, down this path.
Yeah.
No one will possibly suspect this abandoned shack. There are thousands like it all over America. Ah, here we are. Notice how the lock on the door has been hidden. See, it is behind this board.
Excellent, Herr Doctor.
Now I unlock the door.
Herr Doctor, like a laboratory.
Yes, a complete laboratory. Over there, a powerful shortwave sending and receiving set. In that corner, a dark room for developing important photographs we may find it necessary to take. But look over here.
Yeah?
This trap door leads to a deep cellar. Help me lift it.
Yeah.
Follow me down the ladder, Hans.
Yeah.
Where is that light switch? Ah, here it is.
Wunderbar. The telephone switchboard.
Yes. When we have found the cable, we will tap the wires into the switchboard. Then, Hans, not only can we listen here, but we can transfer the calls if we wish. Come, you're wasting precious time. Here are two spades. We must dig for that cable. Come now. Unfortunately, Hans, we were unable to deliver the Grayson submarine.
But if I say
that is a small matter. The important thing is the master plan.
Yeah, master plan.
There are people, Hans, who may be in our way. This newspaper reporter, Clark Kent. Possibly his editor. Or even that main girl. We must be careful.
Yeah, Herr Doctor.
No matter what, Hans, no matter if it means death, the master plan cannot fail. Deep, Hans. Deep.
As the two enemies of peace dig for the buried telephone cable that may be a source of important confidential information, Clark Kent and Commander Leeds, head of the naval base, are engaged in conversation in the latter's office when the phone rings.
Excuse me, Kent. Commander Leeds speaking. Yes? Good. Send him right over. Lewis, the Secret Service man assigned to the base, will be here in a few minutes.
Well, how can he help us, Commander? Deutch and his henchmen are gone. It's up to the police to find them.
I know, but there's more to this than appears on the surface. Deutch isn't just a run-of-the-mill spy. He must have an organization behind him. Otherwise, how would he dare try anything like kidnapping the Grayson submarine by encircling it with a huge steel net and dragging it to a hidden cove?
He's daring, all right. And clever. Did you read the report on that house they were operating from?
Yes. They had a 5,000-horsepower motor fed from a dynamo.
Hmm.
That's what they used to pull the cable that was attached to the submarine net. They're clever, Kent. Oh, come in, Lewis.
Commander.
Shake hands with Clark Kent.
Glad to know you, Mr. Kent.
How do you do?
Well, Lewis, what have you learned?
Very little, Commander Leeds. I questioned the man who was bringing them from the submarine to the detention pen. He claims he was struck from behind.
How did they manage to get a car, Mr. Lewis?
Yes, an official car with a key in the ignition.
Now, we haven't checked that through yet, but I wouldn't worry about them if I were you, Commander. We'll nail them sooner or later.
But in the meantime, I've got to answer for that escape. You say you questioned the yard officer and he claimed someone struck him from behind?
Yes, sir.
Who was that someone?
I suppose we can assume it was either Deutsch or Hans.
We can't assume things, Kent. What about it, Lewis?
Well, I don't know, sir, but don't worry ahead about it. Within 24 hours, we'll have them back in the detention pen.
Men like that can do a lot of damage in 24 hours.
It just occurred to me, Commander. Who ordered them taken to the detention pen? It was my understanding you were going to question them first.
That's right. Who did order it? Lewis, do you know?
Well, I thought you issued the order, sir.
I certainly did not.
And perhaps it was Captain Denning.
No, I'm sure the yard officer told me Commander Leeds had issued the order.
And I tell you I didn't.
Well, there's one easy way to find out. Ask the yard officer.
I left him in the infirmary getting a scalp wound patched up.
What's his name?
Ensign Carter.
I'll find out who issued that order if it's the last thing I do. Commander Leeds speaking. Locate Ensign Carter, yard officer. Have him report to my office at once. Try the infirmary first.
Of course, you may have forgotten having given the order, Commander. After all, there was a lot of excitement when the Grayson sub came in.
I don't forget things like that, Kent. And anyway, it couldn't have been a verbal order. All detention orders must be made out on a specified form and signed by an officer.
Well, what difference does it make who issued the order?
It may not make any difference to you, Lewis. You're a civilian government employee. You can't appreciate the necessity of maintaining strict supervision of the armed forces. Ah, that must be the yard officer now. Come in! At ease, Ensign. Close the door. How do you feel?
Not too bad, sir. Outside of a headache.
You may have a chair.
Thank you, sir.
I have a few questions I'd like to ask you, Mr. Carter. I'll try not to keep you too long since you've gone through quite an ordeal.
That's quite all right, sir.
Tell me, Mr. Carter, who delivered the two prisoners to you for transportation to the detention pen?
Lieutenant Evans, sir. He was aboard the submarine and delivered both men, handcuffed.
Are you sure they were handcuffed?
Why, yes.
Just a minute, Kent. We'll come to that later. You know, of course, Mr. Carter, that incarceration in the detention pen cannot be made without a written order signed by an executive officer.
I know that, sir.
Oh, you do? Then who signed the order for the two prisoners?
Why, you did, sir.
What?
I told you.
Now, hold on. Ensign, do you mean to sit there and tell me that I signed an order to remove those men from the submarine to the detention cell?
Yes, sir.
Where is the order?
I have it here in my pocket, sir. This is it.
Let me see that.
Well, I'll be... Kent, I would have sworn I never issued this.
But that's my signature, all right.
May I see it a moment, Commander?
No doubt about it. I must be getting old, suffering from lapse of memory. What are you doing, Kent?
Looking at it through a magnifying glass.
Oh, it's my signature. There's no doubt about it.
Oh, I'm afraid I'll have to disagree with you, Commander Leeds. This is a tracing of your signature. Mr. Lewis, take a look at it.
Kent, are you trying to tell me...
You've guessed it, Commander. There's a traitor right here at the naval base. Someone who forged your signature to free those two foreign agents. Possibly one of your own men.
Is Clark Kent right? Was Commander Leeds' signature forged on the detention order? If it was, who is the traitor? And how long can he work hand in hand with Dr. Deutch and his gang before being exposed?
Don't forget, tune in again for the next thrilling episode with Superman!
Look, up in the sky!
It's a bird! It's a plane!
It's Superman!
And there you go, going back 83 years, May 23rd, 1941, here on Superman, Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. May I thank you so much for spending part of your Thursday with us. On Friday, we'll have more crime, Dragnet, Night Watch, Suspense, Mr. District Attorney, and Claudia. And then on Saturday, something a little bit different. We'll have a pair of episodes of Suspense, one from early in the run, one from late in the run, and then we'll have two editions of yours truly, Johnny Dollar, one from late in the run and one from early in the run, starring John Lund. That'll all be coming up on Saturday. On Sunday, we will have Fred Allen, My Friend Irma, Jimmy Durante, Amos and Andy, and another episode of Superman, where this one we get to new folk. So that's all coming up here. Hey, thanks for making us a part of your day. We'll see you on Friday with more crime. And we'll also see you anywhere. Come by our webpage, classicradio.stream, classicradio.stream. For more Classic Radio Theater, I'm Wyatt Cox.